Good morning and welcome to the 20th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2023. I've received apologies from Stephanie Callaghan and Tess White. James Dornan is joining us as a substitute and David Torrance is joining the committee remotely. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 4 and 5 in private. Are members agreed? Thank you very much. The second item on our agenda is the continuation of our scrutiny of frontline NHS boards. And for this morning's session, I welcome to the meeting Callum Campbell, Chief Executive of NHS Lothian, Professor Caroline Hiscock, Chief Executive of NHS Grampian, and Carol Potter, Chief Executive of NHS Fife. And we're going to move straight to questions. Thank you, panel, for being with us this morning. Given the increased cost pressures and increasing demand that health boards are currently facing, what can boards do to reduce deficits as planned and achieve a break-even position? Caroline, are you, your light came on first there.
Did it?
Did.
I'm happy to take that, convener. Morning, convener. Morning, colleagues. So I think the underlying financial position is one part of a pretty complex picture, which I recognise colleagues on the committee have heard from our colleagues across Scotland. From NHS Grampian's perspective, we have a range of things that we are looking to do to move to address that. In 2022, NHS Grampian Board endorsed our new strategic intent, which incorporated our learning from the pandemic and is called our plan for the future. The overarching principles within that and the aim of that is to move us to a more sustainable health and care system, which obviously finances are a core component of. In the current operating environment, we are very, very thoughtful of the interdependencies of both our operating performance, our financial fragility, the fragility, really importantly, of our workforce, and the quality and safety of our services. So in our plan for the future, the sustainability and recovery of the financial position is key. And looking at the overarching position in relation to health and care, we've been very cognisant of the challenges that we are faced with in Scotland, and specifically for me in Grampian. So considering the financial sustainability and recovery of that, we've been thoughtful of the projections relating to the Scottish burden of disease, the population's current health, and what we as a health sector can do to improve that. Growing inequalities, and particularly those relating to health, and of course Scotland's demographic, and again for Grampian, the ageing demographic. So specifically in relation to our financial position, we have shared with the committee, we have a very challenged financial position, which is similar to the rest of the public sector in Scotland, and specifically healthcare. Colleagues will have read the Audit Scotland report and, as I say, had evidence from other chief executives. For NHS Grampian in 22-23, we returned a balanced position, and that was not our projected position. In March 22, we had reported a projected deficit of £19.9 million to Scottish Government. However, the revenue position improved significantly in March. This was because of a number of one-off funding streams from Scottish Government and something that we were able to do in regards to our annual leave accrual. However, even though the board managed to achieve that outturn this year, the underlying financial challenge for Grampian is significant. What's really interesting and important is that we have always achieved revenue balance in Grampian, but we are now seeing a step change in the financial challenges that we face as a board, particularly balancing that with operational service pressures that we face. We've submitted a three-year financial plan, 23-26, to Scottish Government, and we have a five-year medium-term financial framework, which was endorsed by the board in April. The medium-term financial framework is to allow us to prioritise the resources that we have, both to deal with the immediate pressures, but also, really importantly, to move towards sustainable health and care. The medium-term financial framework, I think, acknowledges and reflects the complexity of our financial climate, such as the patterns of funding from Scottish Government, funding levels, predicted rising costs, our changing demographics, as I've mentioned, and burden of disease. So with current planning assumptions, NHS Grampian will not be in a position to balance the revenue position with funding levels and anticipated expenditure over the next 5 years. The in-year financial position is expected to improve year on year. However, by 2028, we anticipate we will still have a deficit. However, we are absolutely moving towards, with our medium-term financial framework, understanding what we can do to improve that position. Part of that will be our 3% savings that we have set out relating to the Value and Sustainability Programme, which is being driven nationally as well as locally. So to be explicit, our annual deficit position for this coming year is, as I said, looking at £60.6 million in year, which will improve, but we will remain in deficit with the current projections in year five. Trying to balance that, so we've got value and sustainability, which we will absolutely focus on delivering the efficiencies where we can, and then focusing on our transformation programmes through our strategic intent, and working really importantly with our partners in local authority, the IGBs, to redesign services. One of the biggest changes that we have in relation to our the way in which we're spending our money is in relation to our staffing costs. We are now spending a higher proportion of our resources on pay costs, that's 54%, and 46% on non-pay. We don't have a particularly different story to tell than anyone else that you've heard giving evidence in the committee around the cost of inflation, increased demand on our health and care system, and the planning assumptions that we're using, particularly around drugs.
Specifically on that point on pay, and I think it is an issue that we'll come on to a bit further on, what percentage of that 54% is spent on locals?
So our expenditure last year on medical locums was £17 million for nursing agencies. So we would separate medical and nursing supplementary staffing and agencies and locums. So medical locums were £17 million and nursing agency was, I think, £12.6 million that we spent on agencies and locum.
Bank or agency, or is that all one figure?
So for medical locums...
No, for nursing.
So nursing, no, that's agency.
£12.6 million on agency.
Agency nurse staffing. Okay. We would... The overarching figure, So supplementary staffing is what I would consider all non-substantive staffing. That would include agency and bank.
Just to drill down into that, because that's what I'm trying to get at. Is that 12.6 million bank and agency, or is it only agency?
Only
agency. Okay. Sandesh Gilhani has a supplementary on this.
Thank you, Convener. It's actually just to drill a bit further. How much did you pay the locum agency fee? So not what proportion then went to the medical staff or the nursing staff, how much money went to the actual agency?
So I don't have the specific figures in front of me, and I'm happy to come back and confirm that in writing to the committee. That obviously varies. So if I speak specifically about nurse agency, it varies depending on the agency that we have to contract with. And I am very pleased to say that we are now in the position where in NHS Grampian we have no colleagues working on what we would call off-contract frameworks. All our agency nurses are now on contract, which means that the percentage that goes directly to the agency is as low as it can be and is nationally agreed. We have only recently got to that position. Within the past month, we had a couple of theatre nurses that we were having to use. So I can get the specific figure back to the committee in writing.
Medical and nursing, please. Yep. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll maybe move to Carol or Callum. I don't know if you want to come in and answer the question I'd asked.
Yeah, I think in relation to financial sustainability, I think in Lothian, fortunately, we did manage to balance the books at the end of the financial year. But going into last financial year, we had a financial gap at the start of the year of £28 million. The start of this financial year, we've got a gap of £52 million. So it is quite a significant challenge for us. The largest part of the problem we've got is trying to balance performance with the money. I think the job of the accountable officers is to do the best they can with the money available to them for the population they serve. So trying to get that balance. But the biggest element of that within Lothian is the fact that we do have a gap between NRAC and what we actually get. And that comes out about £15 million a year. That's actually resulting in us having what I would call a care deficit. Our sites are full, our infrastructure's ageing, so we're actually struggling to meet the demands on the population with that. So there's a bit of growth required there over the next period.
Emma Harper, want to come in here?
Thanks, convener. Good morning to you all. Just to pick up on NRAC and also some other information, in the NHS 5 briefing, it says that there's an increase of people over 65 by 30% projected by 2043. And so that means older population, frailer population, needing more issues. So that, for me, as an operating room nurse, it's hip replacements, knee replacements, cataract surgery, and then some. So how does that work when you're doing your financial planning to, I suppose, to including NRAC as far as how do you project that need?
So if I use Lothian, Carol could speak about five in a second. If I use Lothian as an example, over the last 15 years, there's been a growth of 156,000 in the population. That's without any additional general practices. That would equate on average to 21 additional general practices in Lothian, with the average list size being 7,500. The National Records of Scotland estimate that 84% of this population growth in Scotland will be in Lothian by 2033. So when I talk about our sites currently being full and has been under pressure, that's why I'm saying there's a care deficit. The largest population growth will be in Lothian, and the sites are already full. So that's why we're saying we need to expand primary care and we need to expand our secondary care capacity. The Royal Infirmary of Edinburgh, for instance, the A&E department was designed for a population coming through of about 85,000 a year. We currently see 120,000 to 130,000 a year. That's 330 a day. So the infrastructure's under quite significant pressure. So that's what the population change means. And you're quite right, as that population gets older, the burden of disease with it. So, Carol, if you want to say in about five.
Yep, thank you. So as Callum has mentioned, the NRAC issue is prevalent in Fife as well as in Lothian. I think over the last, since about 2009, that we have seen a shortfall of about £100 million in terms of cumulative position. And as Callum's described, it's very much linked to the care deficit. So what we're seeing is growing demand, not just within our acute setting, but obviously within the primary care setting. So we've seen a reduction in the number of GP practices over the recent years within Fife from 56 to 53. But we've also seen the list sizes growing. And we're seeing that, particularly in areas of higher deprivation, there is a pressure and there is a challenge on primary care and within our hospital settings. In terms of how we address that going forward, in terms of the financials around all of that, what we are looking at locally is it's a two-pronged approach essentially to financial planning. So we're looking at financial improvement and sustainability. So we're looking at productivity. So for example, we have got an excellent day surgery facility within Queen Margaret Hospital, and that's been a real key in us continuing with our performance over the pandemic. But what we're looking at there is that for minimal investment, or managing the investment into that site, how much more activity can we do within the same level of resource? So not adding additional costs, but trying to see how more productive we can be in terms of increasing our day surgery capability. The NRAC gap does bring with it a particular challenge in terms of our cost reduction. So our ability to reduce cost is challenged when we have that lower funding base. But some of the opportunities that we're looking at, which my colleagues have described, Caroline spoke about the supplementary staffing, that's a particular challenge in Fife. In the last financial year, and I don't have the breakdown between nursing and medical, but we spent £45 million out of a circa £900 million budget on supplementary staff, and that's a mix of bank agency, both nursing and medics. So the reduction in our supplementary staffing costs is a real priority for us in terms of looking to balance our position in the coming year.
Okay, thank you.
And we're going to move to James Dornan, who's joining us remotely.
Thank you, Convener. I was just making sure I was off of mute there. I wonder if the panel can tell me, first of all, with Montreal, why is it some boards struggle more than others to achieve financial sustainability? We are all facing, all boards are facing significant pressures and costs, but why is there a variation? And I'm happy to start, not so much at Lothian, because they kind of explained why they think they've got greater costs, but one of the others would be good.
Happy to take that question. So I think part of it, as I say, is linked to the funding envelope, which is the NRAC position, but I won't repeat that. I think there's a number of different nuances within that. So for example, because we have an ageing population, we're also seeing an increased pressure in relation to medicines. So 12% growth in the cost and the volume of drugs, and it's the second highest area of spend after our workforce. So in areas where there is that more prevalent increase in the ageing of the population, then we will see people living longer, which is fantastic, but an increased cost in medicines associated with that. The other comment I would want to make, and apologies, this is not a political statement, but the PFI, the health boards who have PFI contracts, the inflationary uplift that's tied into those contractual agreements is often running much higher than the funding increases that we receive from government. So, for example, within Fife, we've seen a 10% cost pressure as a result of our PFI contract is over and above the funding that we have available. So there's not one single answer, but I think it's a very complex and mixed position, but I don't know if my colleagues...
Can I just come back into Carol first, Convener? I get your answer, and what you've done is you've named some of the issues, but I'm wondering why there's a variation in some of those issues. You're talking about, you know, the elderly, thankfully, living longer, he says, as a 70-year-old. Why does it vary so much in one area than in the other? I think that's probably the main point for me.
I'm happy to attempt to answer that. So I think we've said when we were answering the previous question around the difference and the interdependencies with performance, and I suppose at its simplest, different health boards provide different functions to different populations. One of the key things that we have noticed in Grampian, which sets us on a different place to other boards, because of course as peers we ask ourselves that very question and challenge ourselves all the time around the difference in our performance, in our financial position. Like Callum and Carol, NRAC parity for Grampian is a challenge to the sum of about 18 million a month would be our position that would be different. But our performance, which is absolutely related to our financial position, so supplementary staffing, which has been touched on, depending where you are in Scotland, your requirement to use the right workforce to maintain particular services can put an additional pressure on the money that you spend. We've had a question this morning already about agencies and locums. I think in Grampian in particular, we have over the last decade had an incredibly lean model. So we have one of the lowest bed bases in Scotland per head of the population. And actually, our performance from primary care and our performance flowing out of hospitals is relatively good in comparison nationally. But one of the things we are challenged with is not just the amount of money that we get from Scottish Government, but the pattern in which it comes. So if Grampian receives non-recurring funding, we don't have enough resilience in our system to utilise that with core services. And very often, our only option is to utilise the independent sector for things such as planned care. So one of the pieces of work and the regular dialogues that we're having at the moment is around what can we do to change the pattern of funding. And delighted to say that we have received, for the first time, a proportion of our planned care funding on a recurring basis, which of course allows us to recruit and grow services as core services, recruit local colleagues to support that, and therefore make that more efficient financially and productivity-wise, and also more sustainable.
Okay, thank you for that. Sorry, you want to come in, sir?
Callum, did you want to come in on that?
No.
Okay. Thank you. And Emma Harper has a supplementary.
Thanks. Just a quick supplementary about financial planning. You talked about medications, but that includes also things like insulin pumps and continuous glucose monitoring. And we know that, like, I'm a type 1 diabetic. I've got an insulin pump with continuous glucose monitoring. And I'm reading that there's a 43% reduction in the risk of fatal cardiovascular disease and 29% reduction in all-cause mortality. And that is when we use insulin via pumps, for instance. So we know that, you know, we can reduce the complications by investing in pumps and technology, but that costs more money. So how do you financially plan that? And do we have a national map of continuous glucose monitoring between the boards to see how we compare with complication reduction and insulin pumps and CGM rollout?
I'm not aware if we have a map or not. Certainly each of the boards, I can talk about Lothian, we would try to look at the balance between them, because you pick a really good example, but you could say the same about obesity management, we could say the same about exercise, trying to get that balance between what we call primary prevention, early intervention, and acute treatment is always a challenge. We should always try and look at where we can invest early to try and prevent it. But that's one of the challenges we've got with an ageing population. We do know, unfortunately, with age, the disease burden grows. So while we can delay many things, we can't always prevent them all. But early intervention, and I think that's where we can use the universities, etc., to try and get that sweet spot about how much do we need to invest early to get a proper return on investment. And I think it should always be that way around if we can do it.
Mm-hmm. Thanks.
Thank you. We're going to move on to our next theme, which is performance, which we've touched on a little bit here. So I'll move to Evelyn Tweed's questions.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, panel. Carol, you talk about the waiting well process and how you send out letters to patients when there's long waits. Can you explain that process for us? And can you tell us what sort of patient feedback you're getting? It seems eminently sensible to do this, but I don't think all boards are doing this. And is this something that we could maybe share good practice with?
Yes, certainly happy to answer that. So yes, that's been a real focus for us, obviously, in terms of how we support our patients who are waiting longer. We've been in a fortunate position, I have to say, within Fife through the pandemic, of being able to maintain a relatively high level of performance anyway. So whilst we do have delays and we do have patients waiting longer, we are currently functioning at almost pre-pandemic levels. So we would expect that to have helped the position over recent years. But certainly the conversations and the processes within each of the different specialties around contact with patients is doing that on a very person-centred basis, giving them information about what the expected length of time will be, some of the reasons for that, but also signposting them to other opportunities, so perhaps onto online information, self-help guides, and the ability to also just to remain an open dialogue and have a contact for the patients to be able to get back in touch with their relevant consultant. But I know colleagues across Scotland have been working on that. It's been a national initiative, and we're certainly not we're not trailblazing the way in Fife. I'd like to see that we were, but colleagues with us this morning will also be adopting a very similar approach.
Does anyone want to come in?
I'm happy to do that. So we similarly have had a waiting well project underway for over the past year. In fact, we have just shared the first review report of that, which again, I'm happy to share with the committee. And that has landed very well with patients who are waiting for too long, both for outpatient appointments and for planned care. So we are continuing to evaluate that, but the initial findings are that it has been very successful from the perspective of clinicians and, very importantly, patients, and we have identified funding to continue with that piece of work. As well as Waiting Well, which is a specific project, we have developed our Fit Surgery website, have a process around our waiting list validation, which again will be not unique to Grampian, and have an escalation system between patients, secondary care, primary care colleagues for patients whose condition deteriorate while they are waiting. So it does not solve the problem of patients are most definitely waiting too long, and that not just impacts on their physical health, their psychological health, and that is nothing that any of us are content about, but trying to do the best we can to manage their psychological well-being and mitigate any concerns that we can is a focus of our attention.
Do you want to come in?
Very, very similar. In fairness, we're trying to do as much as we can, but certainly in Lothian we're piloting patient-focused booking to try and reduce our DNAs, so it's a time that's convenient for patient. We're using text reminders, we're trying to use virtual appointments. We're trying to do as much as we can about patient-initiated follow-up rather than us automatically bringing you back, giving you the information, letting the patient highlight when they feel they want to come back. And we're trying to move to as much online booking as we can. We're trying to evaluate these to see how effective they are, and happy to share those final reports when they come in.
Okay. And if I could come back to you, Callum, in terms of your performance and standards just now, some of the areas seem to be deteriorating, and I think you've got issues in a number of areas. How are you going to get on top of that?
So I think there's some areas of strength and there's some areas of weakness. I think if you look at planned care, the treatment time guarantee in Lothian, if I look at March 23, we are back around about 90% of our pre-pandemic capacity. I think across Scotland is about 78%. In relation to outpatients, I think Scotland's round about 86. And sorry, I've got that round the wrong way. Scotland, for outpatients, I think it's at 86. And Lothian was just above the 100 for its outpatients. Or maybe the Scotland figure wrong. But within that, we've got some particular hotspots, so we are under a lot of pressure in urology, and that in particular causes a concern. We're seeing quite a significant rise in men presenting with prostate cancer. We are trying to do something about that. We are trying to move to 3 session days at St John's. We've tried to recruit an additional surgeon. We've tried to alter the pathway for men coming in with query prostate cancer. That's a particular pressure for us. We are trying to recruit. We've got significant challenge around theatre staffing. So we've got a major focus on trying to recruit and retain theatre staff, because that capacity is a rate limiting step in our system. And I think getting that infrastructure in place, I touched on earlier on the fact our sites are regularly at 100%. That's going to be a problem for us. We have challenges in our A&E department. I gave you the figures earlier on about the size of the A&E department versus the population we serve. But one of our biggest weights is in elective orthopaedics. So at a time when we're trying to free up beds, we're going to have to ring-fence beds in the Royal Infirmary of Edinburgh for elective orthopaedics to try and make sure we're not cancelling them on the day, which actually means we're going to have to do some orthopaedic rehab out at East Lothian Community Hospital. So try to alter those pathways are all steps we're trying to do for each of those specialties. But it's going to be quite a long journey. And as I say, without additional infrastructure, we will struggle.
Paul Sweeney.
Thanks very much. And I know some of the points you've made about capacity and constraints, and I think that is a major concern. You mentioned, for example, A&E departments being designed for a lower population. Do you have other metrics that you assess capacity and bottlenecks, obviously looking at a process mapping of your services, where there are areas of constraint, say around key items of capital equipment like CT or MRI scanners? Are these areas which you've identified are needing extra capital investment which would improve patient flow? I just wondered if you have particular examples that you have identified in your analysis of operations.
I'm happy to start with that. So, picture very similar to Callum's, but to answer your question specifically, one of the most, I think, helpful and emergent pieces of work that we have undertaken in Grampian has been what we would call breach analysis of our 62-day cancer pathway. So, like other parts of our system, access to the range of services that are required for a patient and their family in receiving a cancer diagnosis, we have reviewed and renewed our process for breach analysis. So every step in that pathway, how long does it take, what are the bits that are working well, and what are the components that are challenged. And we have designed that with colleagues who do this day in and day out. And that is a piece of work that has been shared across Scotland. What that has allowed us to do is to specifically identify bottlenecks, as you have asked, for each cancer type, and to therefore target the resource that we have in the right place. So for prostate cancer or for colonoscopies, understanding if the delay and performance relating to 62 days is because patients can't get access to theatre for a surgical intervention in a timely enough way, or if it's because they can't get access to an MRI scanner or to other imaging. So we now have that information, which we haven't had before, to a level of detail that is incredibly useful to both our primary care, secondary care colleagues, and to allow us, as I say, to target where we put the finite resource that we have to make pathways as efficient as possible. Some of the other things in relation to sustainability and what do we do with those bottlenecks is not just about pieces of more of the same kit. There's also some really, I'm going to say, brilliant innovations that are underway. And when we spoke earlier about sustainability and planned care, innovation has to be part of how we move forward with that. So a couple of examples, and because I've been talking about the cancer pathway, our ability to use artificial intelligence. Grampian is piloting a piece of work for Scotland in collaboration with the Centre for Sustainable Delivery in breast and chest imaging. chest X-ray imaging. So chest X-rays are a pretty standard diagnostic tool. Most people that come into hospital will receive a chest X-ray. However, the ability for us to do that X-ray and then report in a timely way has always been challenged. In Grampian, we've now been piloting artificial intelligence alongside the expertise of our radiology colleagues, which allows us to develop algorithms which prioritise patients who have red flags on their chest X-ray. So what that means is, as opposed to the historical process, which meant that patient images waited in a queue from when they attended to be reported, which is the formal process, artificial intelligence now allows us to do that in a prioritised way and to potentially reduce our pathways and access and alleviate bottlenecks, because imaging reporting would have been a specific bottleneck.
That's very helpful. Yeah.
Maybe build on that, yeah. Certainly. So there's a few examples that if I could offer. So in relation to, if I sort of take your question in two halves around capital investment, but also in bottlenecks generally, in terms of capital investment, we certainly purchased in the last 12 months two additional CT scanners. So that has supported the throughput of our radiology patients, which has been a particular challenge for us within Fife. So that's supporting that wider pathway. We have a rapid cancer diagnostic service, again, which is also helping in terms of how we are seeing and treating our cancer patients, but Caroline's obviously touched on that. One particular investment I would want to mention is that through some innovation in terms of slightly different ways of working, we have increased and developed the use of a procedure room within Queen Margaret Hospital. But what that has done is that has allowed us to release one theatre per day within that site, which is where we do our day surgery. So that has released, in some respects, a bottleneck in relation to elective care, so thereby allowing that throughput. And we are looking, we're challenging, the consultants are challenging themselves on, within, at a specialty level, what more can be done in a day surgery basis that's not necessarily requiring the specialised inpatient hospital in the Victoria and Kirkcaldy. So just looking innovatively and looking at redesign. In terms of other bottlenecks, it's maybe a slightly different angle that I'd like to come at, but we often talk about bottlenecks at the front door of the hospital. And by that, we're referring to ambulances and the emergency department. But if we go one step earlier into the front door of the patient themselves, one of the areas that we've been looking at with our colleagues in the Health and Social Care Partnership is how do we support people within care homes in a different way. So we have improved access to urgent care for a number of our care home residents, and that has allowed, or that has involved, through our flow navigation centre, what we call a prof-to-prof, so professional-to-professional contact, so care homes can directly access a clinical professional to discuss one of the residents if they've got concerns around their particular health needs. We also have teams of advanced nurse practitioners and allied health professionals as part of a multidisciplinary team who are essentially doing virtual ward rounds within care homes across all seven of our localities. And we're also working with the ambulance service to deliver some direct unscheduled care into care homes. And the reason for me mentioning that is that that has directly resulted in a reduction of about 220 emergency admissions or emergency attendances a month. That's reduced it to just above 100, and the success of that really has come from that wider whole system working. So it's been taking a step back, looking at the problem from a slightly different perspective and involving all the different teams and professionals across the NHS and the partnership, and it's been better for those residents in the care homes who have been kept in their place of home with care wrapped around them, so avoiding that bottleneck for them in an ambulance or at the front door of the hospital.
Yeah. You both highlighted what sounds quite impressive process improvement activities. I just wonder, from a cultural perspective across the health boards, how do you disseminate best practice and how do you benchmark against each other so that you're able to say, right, that's an excellent work stream, how do we carry that over into the national picture so we can make an impact? Is that something you, is it, do you have a protocol or a process for doing that?
So, So the Centre for Sustainable Delivery tries to work on areas where there's potential improvement, and they've got a number of work streams across a number of different specialties to try and optimise performance in that area. The Board Chief Execs meet every month and will share information. We also use Discovery, which is a national benchmarking tool, which enables you to look at your own performance and your infrastructure against others. So you can look at variation, and then when you see variation, you can try and explore behind it. Why are things different? What's going on different there versus your own board, to try and identify if there's an opportunity for improvement.
Do you feel it's effective? Could it be more efficient? Is there ways to improve it further?
I think there's always opportunities to improve, without doubt. So I think it's part of the reason it's there is to explore that. I don't think there's any massive steps that could be made, but certainly you'll always get incremental improvement.
Do you have team-to-team collaboration at a lower level than the boards across different health boards, where you've done something operationally where you can then teach others how to do that well?
To add to that, so not only do we work as teams, all of the chief executives coming together on a regular basis, and we obviously share some of that learning, but we also work regionally as well. So myself, Callum, and our colleague Rafe Roberts from NHS Borders, we meet on a regular basis as well. So through the three of us, but also through our teams, come together as well once a month. So we share learning in a variety of different areas as well, and I'm sure it's the same within the north, where Caroline is.
Yeah, I'm happy just to add, so we do have a similar setup in the north, east and west. I think the ownership, if you like, and the motivation of our colleagues in all specialties to improve things and move things forward often results in a lot of informal networking, but we also have a range of formal networks across Scotland where best practice is shared. And just to add to Callum's narrative on CFSD, they have in the recent past established specialty clinical groups where specialist clinicians where clinicians from different specialties come together to do exactly as you're describing, which is to make sure that we are doing what we can around sharing best practice in different contexts. And I think it's really important to say that despite the pressures that we've described, we are hugely proud of our colleagues across health and care who come to work every day and keep the show on the road and do an amazing job, but also are genuinely trying to improve and find solutions all the time to make the current system perform more effectively for patients.
Thanks. I'm going to come to James Dornan for a supplementary.
This obviously touches on financial sustainability as well as performance, but fundamentally, do you think that there's a need to transform the way in which services are delivered? Do you think the way they're delivered just now is fine? It's just they need to have some of the innovation that you've already mentioned.
I think undoubtedly. I think that it touches on performance, it touches on financial sustainability, it touches on the fact that health has got an insatiable appetite. But the reality is, if you look at the demography of the nation, we're just not going to have the workforce to provide the services in the format and style that we currently provide them just as you move through the next 10 to 20 years. So there is going to have to be a fundamental rethink as to how do we best provide the health services to best meet the population needs. I think demography automatically takes you there.
Thanks.
And any
of
the others?
I'm happy to add to that. So just to support Callum's position, absolutely how we transform locally and nationally has to be part of our consideration. The Scottish burden of disease is forecast to increase by 21% in the next 20 years, which to specifically relate back to Callum's point, if the models of care were to remain extant, then we would need an additional approximately 33,000 whole-time equivalents on top of our current workforce, which, as we know, is a challenge. So the more that we can work to transform our system, to empower communities and provide a better balance of enabling wellness as well as responding to ill health is the sustainable way forward.
And if I could add to that, I think there's something as well around how do we have a slightly different dialogue with the public around what a modern NHS looks like. We need to look, I think, perhaps wider than our traditional approach of looking at what are the services that we're delivering within hospitals, and looking more broadly into the third sector, into the services within health and social care partnerships, but even into primary care, or particularly into primary care. So the role of community pharmacy is huge, and there's a lot that pharmacists can offer that might avoid somebody having to attend their GP or attend hospital. We have community optometrists who are linking more closely with our ophthalmology services as well. So it's having a different dialogue. We all talk about going to see your GP, but actually what we really mean is we're going to our local primary care provider, and that may well be an advanced nurse practitioner, or it might be a physio, but we describe talking about going to see the GP. So we maybe need to shift our language and have that engagement and the dialogue with the public as well, so that we listen to the public, but we also communicate around what is that wider role of the primary care practitioner.
Thanks, James.
Thank you.
Sandhya Kohani.
Thank you, convener. Can I ask you about NHS Lothian's hospital sterilisation and decontamination unit? Obviously, everyone's been talking about increasing the work that you do within a theatre complex, but you can't do anything if you don't have any kit. So your specific sterilisation unit is severely over capacity right now. What steps have you taken and are taking to ensure that you can not only meet the demand right now, but that of your ambition going forwards?
One of the conversations we've had with the Scottish Government is the fact that Lothian would like to take forward a capital programme for a national treatment centre. We recognise that the decontamination capacity, not just in Lothian, but in other boards in Scotland, is fragile. So one of the things we've actually proposed as part of that is that we look to expand the decontamination capacity for the national treatment centre in Lothian, which would be St John's, to increase the decontamination capacity, not just to meet Lothian's need, but also to create some resilience within the Scottish decontamination capacity, to make it more sustainable.
So you plan to expand it?
Yes.
What steps have you done already? Because you need to have done something already, but also one of the questions at the very beginning was about a lack of money and how you've got a deficit going forward. So there is a lack of capital to support new things, especially plans to do that. So how will you achieve your plans with this deficit?
So the issue in Lothian is we do have enough decontamination capacity, but we don't have any resilience around our decontamination capacity. So our decontamination unit went down recently. When that went down, there wasn't enough resilience elsewhere in the country to support it. We had to get support from down south. We were moving instruments right around the country. So we do currently have enough capacity. We are looking at that infrastructure. We're trying to protect that infrastructure, but there's just not the resilience within it. I don't see a shortcut to being more resilient, either in Lothian or nationally, without that. And that's why one of the reasons we've made one of our primary capital priorities as additional decontamination capacity. I don't see an alternative shortcut to that.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm now going to move on to the next theme, and Emma Harper.
Thank you, convener. So we've talked a little bit about COVID recovery and you know the challenges of performance as in pre-pandemic levels and where we are currently. So, and a lot of the responses you've made have touched on COVID as well, and I absolutely think we can't ignore that because we've just coming through a pandemic. You know, we're still recovering. A lot of folk think it's going to be an overnight fix, and it's not. So I'm interested to hear your thoughts on on the recent NHS overview audit, where Audit Scotland states that the Scottish Government didn't fully engage with NHS boards in the preparation of the recovery plan. So I'm interested in what you think about that statement from Audit Scotland, but also, you know, have you made changes to the recovery plan to adapt and evolve based on knowledge that we've learned from the pandemic?
So in Lothian, we have a Lothian Strategic Development Framework, which we have openly shared with the Scottish Government, so that will have informed some of the planning there. We are very clear on our capacity, both in outpatients and inpatients, for each of the services we can provide. And to a degree, the unknown factors of demand that's coming in, one of the rate-limiting steps, and you're quite right, I think it's going to be a long journey, as we find an awful lot of pressure in our social care colleagues that is limiting our flow through our system. When the flow is limited, then the amount of activity we can get through is diminished, and that does affect the recovery period for the system. I think you're quite right to flag the challenge that COVID has presented. We had a really good waiting list position. We were under pressure pre-pandemic. Post-pandemic, I think it's going to be many years to recover from it.
Callum's comments. I think prior to the pandemic, we were seeing significant challenges. Anyway, my background is a finance director prior to being chief executive, and we saw the financial challenges before the pandemic. We also saw challenges around our emergency unscheduled care, and also within our hospitals in terms of electives. So I think in some respects, the pandemic has exacerbated what was probably we were facing before then. I think the challenge we have is that if I talk specifically around recovery of waiting times. So there is a challenge around the financials associated with that and the cost involved. But equally, we are looking at a range of opportunities to increase the throughput of our elective capacity in terms of that recovery. So we're looking, as I mentioned earlier, about improving and removing any barriers to procedures that we could be recommended for day surgery. We've spoken this morning about digital solutions. How can we support our patients in that regard? We're using an app for patients in terms of pre-assessment ahead of surgery. Teams, as Caroline has touched on, our clinicians and our teams continue to review how they can work differently, and they're very, very committed to doing everything they can for their patients. We have a range of improvement actions that we've described that the Centre for Sustainable Delivery have outlined and that we're working collaboratively and together with. But really, despite all of that, we have got workforce challenges, which I know is an area of interest of the committee, and that is a limiting factor, and our capacity is struggling to meet to keep up with the demand, and that I think is prevalent across all areas. So we have all got very robust and detailed forward plans of our ability to address our waiting times going forward, both the length of the wait and the size of the waiting list. But the challenges do remain, and as we've outlined already, there are a number of particular specialties that are particularly stretched, and that can be for a variety of reasons, some of which is available workforce in those particular areas.
Mm-hmm. If you had some key asks for things that would really help to curtail, to prevent, the shortening of the recovery or enhancing the recovery, what would your key asks be?
I think the biggest rate-limiting step is social care flow. I think our colleagues in social care are under significant pressure. That is limiting the capacity within the NHS, and I think we have to accept that health and social care are so fundamentally linked. So I think if we could ease the burden on social care, I think certainly from my perspective would be the biggest ask. Mm-hmm.
I think from my perspective, the continued support of our colleagues across health and care, and Carol's already mentioned how do we engage effectively. We'll be doing it locally through routes such as our community planning partnerships and our locality networks. But how do we truly harness the empowerment of local communities, as we did during the pandemic, in designing our NHS going forward, NHS and social care going forward, because they are inextricably linked. And actually being able to work with our local populations as locally as possible to support citizens, as well as be supported nationally with some of the things that would help us. So conversations that are engaging and truly listening at all levels, locally, regionally and nationally with the public, to help us move forward as quickly as we can in relation to recovery.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you. I'm going to move now to David Torrance, joining us remotely.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to witnesses. Around the recovery plan and the progress NHS boards have made, how accurate is Audit Scotland's assessment that of October 2022, progress updates does not fully reflect the scale of the challenges boards have faced and the extent to which this has hampered progress towards recovery by many individual boards? I'll go to Carol first.
David, good to see you. I think Audit Scotland have, a unique opportunity in terms of seeing that overall picture across NHS Scotland and triangulating all of the different data and metrics that they look at. I think it would be remiss of me to counter what they are saying around the challenges that are facing all boards. As we mentioned earlier on, recovery is it's not, there is no single solution to recovery. There's the short-term focus on addressing our waiting times and also dealing with the pressures around the front door of our hospitals, but we also need to be focusing on the longer term. We talk about the Horizon 3. We have lots of conversations amongst chief executives in that regard, so we need to be looking at the same time as balancing the priorities for recovery immediately. We also need to be looking longer term at the health and wellbeing of the population more generally and all of the factors associated with people's life circumstances, and we know that housing and education, lots of other metrics, affect somebody's longer term health prospects. So I think it's a reasonable assessment. I'm not going to, as a former accountant, I'm not going to challenge Audit Scotland on their perception, but I certainly recognise the comments that they have made.
Just to expand on what Carol was saying, I think that in Lothian, I was saying that basically the sites are very full most of the time. But you add on top of that, the thing that will dictate the pace is the workforce that we've got. And there is a significant workforce challenge. I think going back to March there was about 4,200 registered nurse vacancies in Scotland. You touched on the point about agency staffing. With the sites full, we do need the workforce. There was about 1,500 non-registered nurse vacancies in Scotland. So trying to get the workforce there, it's back to the point about demography. We need the workforce to deliver the performance. Workforce equally costs money. Trying to get the balance between them. So I think Audit Scotland quite rightly highlight what a significant challenge this is going to be.
And finally, I would agree with both Carol and Callum. I think for our system, the evidence that was presented in Audit Scotland report, although specific for Scotland, obviously reflects a growing body of evidence globally in relation to how we manage effectively the interdependencies of our risks associated with further infectious diseases, the cost of living crisis, a very fragile health and care system, and climate fragility. So I think that the work that was presented there and the work that we are doing as individual boards through our delivery plans to move towards recovery we'll start to address that, but it has been in relation specifically to what has changed. And in Grampian, we have absolutely noticed a change in our demand profile. Similarly to Callum, Our bed occupancy in Aberdeen Royal Infirmary, which is our main tertiary secondary care site, in the last week of May, so last week, was sitting at 106%. That's an optimal system, should be sitting at 87% bed occupancy. So the ability for us to take a step back, to take our learning from the pandemic, to look at the evidence in UK and globally around sustainable health and care systems, and clearly within that, our workforce is a key component, which is our workforce numbers have increased in the last year. However, that has not been across all domains and applied uniformly. And we have definitely in Grampian some highly specialist areas which are fragile. We have improvement work around that. But specifically, I would cite psychiatry as a very fragile professional specialty at the moment, and paediatric anaesthetics, actually. So where we have a small number of specialists coming through, so we are working with NES and others around the pipeline, if you like. That's very specific around our medical profession, but the demand profile and workforce would be key to our recovery.
Thank you for that. Are there any particular areas the witnesses would highlight where good progress has been made, and what are the reasons for this? I've got you as well, Carol, first.
Okay, so without apologies for a bit of repetition, I would go back to the ability that we had during the pandemic in Fife to essentially protect the capacity within the D surgery unit at Queen Margaret Hospital, and that certainly was key to us enabling us to sustain our elective programme, and it's absolutely fundamental to the post-recovery plan as well, and we are expanding that further. So it's the ability, I think, to, as I say, to ensure that we are maintaining that balance of demand, so that we're balancing the need to address the challenges that Caroline has described around capacity, around unscheduled care and the emergency demands on our services, at the same time as balancing that with the need to have a throughput of patients who have been waiting too long for elective procedures. So it's something about how we're using our infrastructure in a very planned way, and I know that Callum mentioned some work earlier on at the Royal Infirmary around protecting beds as well. So I think that's what's going to be really key.
I'm happy to add. So I think for Grampian, one of the key things that we have done well and continue to do well is to work as a much more integrated system. So I've reflected several times in this conversation today about the interdependencies, and we now have teams that are absolutely working together. So we are challenged, as you will know, around the majority of our performance metrics and the relationship between unscheduled care and planned care and cancer are very apparent. So in relation to the work we're doing with our primary care colleagues, Grampian has one of the lowest attendances from primary care into the front door services at hospital per head of the population. Our primary care colleagues, despite the challenges, are continuing to do a very good role around that. We also have one of the lowest admission rates. Of course, our social care sector is challenged, but our work to manage flow across the system has meant that our delayed discharges are they've been pretty constant, and they benchmark reasonably well across Scotland. There are other aspects of care that we have focused on around improving issues that remain challenged, so our psychological therapies. We made a commitment to not have any citizens in Grampian waiting more than 52 weeks for their appointment, and we now have achieved that. That is still too long in relation to the target that the population deserve and expect, but we are incrementally improving that. CAMHS in Grampian remains high performing in relation to the first the first appointment. The national target is 18 weeks, and a young adult in Grampian should get access to their first appointment between 6 and 8 weeks. That's great. However, it is also creating a follow-up challenge for us in regards to secondary appointments. So that's a good news story as well as a challenge that's creating. So I think we are seeing incremental improvements, but as we've discussed in previous parts of this conversation, the recovery is going to be slow and requires a transformation as well as improvements. I also mentioned the innovations relating to artificial intelligence and imaging. Similarly, our ability to do a one-stop radiotherapy piece of work for cancer patients has been significant and very positive for patients who are suffering from cancer and require radiotherapy.
I wonder if I could add, just Caroline mentioned some work with the partnerships. I think one of the areas, the question was around where we've seen success. And I think what I would want to highlight is that one of the successes that we've had that I've really noticed has sort of shone through has largely been about how we've worked as opposed to necessarily what we've been doing. So how we've worked in terms of, we use the term Team Fife in a lot of conversations around how we're approaching the challenges facing us, but there's been a relentless commitment from colleagues across all areas, whether it's Health and Social Care Partnership or Acute Service or our leadership teams as well, to focus on, I think, the expression of being complete, not compete. So get to the end point. What is it? What's the end point or the intention that we're working towards? And whether that's been around the challenge around delayed discharges, whether it's been redesign around the front door of the hospital, all of these programmes of work have been successful where the teams have worked together in a really collaborative way. So it's about the relationships and not necessarily what they're doing. It's how they're approaching that and that single focus. And we have a tool that we've mentioned in the briefing that is our operational escalation framework, our OPAL tool, and that's a language that's used across the organisation. But again, that's shared language and shared approach and common purpose. So we had success during the pandemic. I think we all recognised that when we came together to work collectively, collegiately, collaboratively, whether that was the public, our teams and others and across the community planning partnerships, that's where we saw success, and that's something I think we need to really build on and develop further.
Thank you, Convener. I have no further questions.
Thank you, David. I'm going to now move to Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you, Callum. Can I turn to you? I'd like to ask you about audiology. So the Families Failed by Lothian Audiology Action Group, FLAG, they've said quite a few things in public, and I'd like to raise them directly with you to get a response, please. They feel that there is a lack of access to British Sign Language tutors, as well as a lack of access for speech and language therapy and appropriately qualified professional support deaf children. So the question is, what support are you putting in place for families that are affected, and what would you say in response to FLAG?
So I think the first thing I have to do is apologise that the whole issue started off in the first place. So I think the Ombudsman's report, the work we had through the review was quite a wake-up call in Lothian, and we're grateful for the efforts that went in around that. Jackie Taylor, the independent chair, made a number of recommendations. NHS Lothian has followed every one of those recommendations. We have communicated widely across speech and language therapy, health visitors, the five local authorities. We've been very open around the challenges. We have tried to contact every single family, and I'll come back to one particular point in a second. We don't just use British Sign Language, though, is one point I would make. Our speech and language therapists will say there are other forums we do use. We do make available British Sign Language, but it's not the only forum of sign language. I am not aware that we have limited in any way speech and language therapy. And we have met a group of MSPs less than a month ago. The same comment made to us. We have put additional resources into speech and language therapy. Now, there is a balance, I accept, that some families might want more, but where we believe there is a need that speech and language therapy is there, we have not limited it. We have significantly invested in there. So I think there are challenges for us. It's been a long journey. We've retrained all our staff. We believe we have got to everybody, but we can never be positive around that. And one of the MSPs flagged one person they think we've missed. We've reached out to say, if we think we've missed you, please come forward, we'll check. So we do think we've done everything reasonably that we can to do it. We have tried to make available British Sign Language, although we make the point there are other forums of sign language there. We've communicated extensively. We've had a telephone line available throughout the period. I think we've had 24 calls to it throughout that period. And we'll follow MD up if any MP, MSP, councillor flags MD to us, we will follow them up to make sure that if we catch everybody from this.
Okay, so I mean, obviously the thing that's very concerning is the development of speech occurs between birth and three, and that's when you become really fluent when your speech, and the average age of identification is about 4.5. And from my understanding, the cutoff has been 2018. So what's happening to potential families?
No, so the cut-off, the original review from the British Society of Audiologists was about 2009 to 2018. That was the first review. There have been two subsequent reviews. So all children from 2018 up to now who we have any concern around ABR have been back. We have been back and checked. So we have been back, they've been checked. So they are all been checked out. So the 2018 cut-off was the first cohort, and that was the review one. There have been two subsequent reviews carried out. We've tried to be as extensive as we can in addressing this.
Okay, and so to be clear from what you've said, you feel that you've identified everyone that's been affected?
I would caveat it for the fact I did meet some MSPs a month ago who flagged us, they thought there was one family that we'd missed, and we've said, please let us know who that is and we'll follow them up. So we do believe we have, but I do need to caveat that.
Okay. And you've increased your resources into audiology, getting speech and language and audiology, and you don't feel that there is a lack of access to the British Sign Language tutors for those who want it?
Within the NHS, I believe if somebody requires a British Sign Language support, we're able to get it within the NHS. I couldn't talk broader than the NHS.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Paul Sweeney.
In written evidence from NHS Lothian, you noted there's no low secure forensic units in the health board and no female high secure beds in Scotland more broadly, with people being managed in units that aren't suitable. So how are your health board managing this lack of forensic mental health capacity, and what could government do to improve this situation?
So I think mental health, as we all know, is sometimes a bit of a Cinderella service. We are having to use our medium secure unit both for some patients who actually could cope well in low secure, and we're actually having to have a high secure female patient and our medium secure unit as well. So effectively what that's doing is that's squeezing us. We're losing 25% of our medium secure capacity because there's either low secure individuals in there or we're accommodating a high secure female in there. We do have business cases together to try and expand our capacity, but it is a need to get the balance between psychiatric wards, IPCUs, low secure, medium secure capacity across Scotland, and certainly high secure for females.
Just one other area I wanted to touch on more broadly. Is CAMHS referrals being rejected? And I have noted there has been a significant increase in this pattern across Scotland in the last 5 or 6 years. 2017-2018, 11 people were re-referred in Fife, but the, last year it was 46. In Grampian over the same period, it was 161, now 260. And in Lothian, it was 287, now up to 416. So I just want to understand more about what the reasons might be behind GPs having to try more than once to get successful CAMHS referrals, and what might be the case. Is it due to capacity? Is it thresholds being higher than what GPs are assessing as appropriate? Just be interested to get your insights as to what might be going on there with that trend.
So I was relatively quiet earlier on when we were talking about improvements. One of the challenges Lothian had pre-pandemic was in both our CAMHS and psychological therapies waiting lists. We were escalated for them. We have seen over the last 2.5 years a continued reduction within those waiting lists. One of the things we have developed in Lothian is pathways working with partners around what we would call sort of tier two CAMHS, because too many young children were getting referred into tier three CAMHS, community CAMHS, where other support services, not medicalising so much at level two, would be more appropriate. So we've worked hard to develop those services, and that's where we believe quite a high percentage of those patients could be there. So they will be considered, but actually will then be directed to the appropriate place for them, depending on their clinical presentation and need.
Okay.
To add to that, yeah. Very similar. So we are seeing an increasing referral rate, not just in childhood mental health, also in adult, but specifically for CAMHS. The triage, we use the CAPA model as well, so choice and partnership, and the triage and redirection of patients will be about the most appropriate place. So there will be no child or young adult that is referred into our system that is not signposted to the appropriate the appropriate service for their level as assessed by clinicians in Grampian. We are using the national framework for decision making around CAMHS and embedding that, and as well as the planned appointments, we will also provide an emergency service, so all emergency referrals are seen within 7 days in Grampian.
If I can build on that as well, I think what we have certainly seen is over the last few years, the complexity and the mix, if you like, of referrals has increased. So prior to 2021, it was about 50% of young people who would be classified as high priority. Now that's shifted to about 80%. What we are seeing, though, is that earlier redirection into other areas of support. So there's a support coming through school and online tools as well. We've now got mental health nurses being rolled out into GP practices as well, so that's certainly helping. And a real, I think it's been an area of focus across Scotland in terms of innovation, different ways of looking at pathways and adapting the CAMHS service to more appropriately support the spectrum of needs of our young people, whether that's initial treatment all the way through to, we've got a test of change at the moment with our education colleagues that are supporting those with complex mental health needs as they turn 18 and they're starting to move into adult services. How can we support them further with self-help tools and other aspects as well as supporting them in that face-to-face way? So a slightly different approach, but as colleagues have also mentioned, our performance has improved and the long waits have been reduced significantly. But it is a complex area, and I think it's a growing area. The last few years have been extremely difficult for our young people across Scotland.
So would you be confident that this metric, I know it might just be a narrow metric about re-referrals, do you expect, given the measures you've put in place, this to start falling because GPs are now aware of a more appropriate referral pathway? Is that what you're saying, basically?
We would hope so. So again, it's back to that communication between the multidisciplinary teams, working with our general practitioners and colleagues around the appropriateness of referrals.
Okay, thanks. That's great.
Thanks. Can I just, and I'll refer members to my register of interest here. So can I just ask then, is there a case perhaps for some change of language or change of measurement when we talk about rejected referrals, which sounds a very hard thing about you not being seen, to a redirected referral that it comes into an inappropriate service because of level of need or complexity or whatever, and that could be at either end of the care spectrum, whether that be limited intervention or very high intensity intervention, that referral is then redirected to a service that is more appropriate, more clinically appropriate for that person.
Okay. Yes.
Thank you. I'm going to now move on to Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel. At last week's evidence session, we heard from the State Hospital about their use of induction and peer support in regards to recruitment. They said there's been a focus on the development of a peer support network throughout the organisation, and that they now have a number of staff who are trained as peer support workers, and that this has proved successful. I'm interested to know whether there are similar schemes being developed in your boards, how successful they have been, if they are developed, or if you're planning to bring in something similar. And Carol's nodding, so I might go to Carol first.
Thank you. Yes, no, we rolled out peer support within the organisation, I think back in 2021. The initiative actually came from a number of our clinicians who'd been involved in it in previous roles and also just a general interest. Mm-hmm. So it's a great example of we listened and we heard, we did. So we have a number, apologies, I don't have the details to hand, but we have a large number of staff across the organisation, many with clinical backgrounds who are trained in peer support, and that's widely known, widely advertised across the organisation. We have a huge range of staff wellbeing initiatives, and it's something we're really proud of. We know we don't always get it right, but we want to listen to staff. So we've got everything from physical staff hubs on every site within our hospitals. We've been very fortunate to be supported through our health charity in that regard. So we have staff hubs, which are, as I say, are available to all. We have health and wellbeing groups. We've got financial wellbeing guides. We've got menopause support, sport and leisure passes, a whole range of initiatives. But also importantly, we have a staff listening and counselling service, which I think has been hugely I was going to say popular, that feels like the wrong term, but there's been a high demand, and that's where our spiritual care team have reached into the organisation to provide one-to-one support, reflective practice and staff listening. So really going to the heart of how people are feeling about life in general and the workplace, and the peer support, as I say, is one aspect to that.
That's great. I don't know who wants to come next.
Similar, I think that I think Caroline said earlier on, our staff have been great throughout, but they've had a hard time. So we have tried to do a number of initiatives, not just to try and recruit staff, but also to retain them. And certainly a number of wellbeing initiatives across the organisation. We also have Speak Up Ambassadors because, as Caroline says, we don't always get it right. So when we get it wrong, to try and create the culture where people can speak up early, let's intervene early. We do need to recognise, though, that a number of our staff, we've got a significant percentage of our staff that are over the age of 50, so the wellbeing initiatives are actually, it's back to the question your colleague mm-hmm. made earlier on, try to intervene there, support them early, mm-hmm. it helps all the way through. So there's a lot of emphasis on our workforce, our culture, to try and get it right, to try and retain our staff and keep them healthy.
Yeah, so I mentioned our new strategy, and one of the key things was our strategic intent was to prioritise our workforce wellbeing in a way that we had never been able to do. We are on a journey with that, and as Carol has said, we don't get it right every time. We have a number of we have an overarching We Care programme, which has a number of initiatives which include peer support and investment in wellbeing and capacity to support the wellbeing and culture of colleagues working in Grampian, so not just NHS Grampian, but colleagues in the Health and Social Care Partnership, who are obviously employees mm-hmm. of the council as well, so trying to spread that as broadly as possible. So our peer support model for psychological first aid is now rolled out in 11 different service areas. We have an app that we are using to raise concerns. We have Speak Up Ambassadors, but we have an app called Trickle, which allows colleagues to use an app to, to raise questions and have them answered. A couple of just additional things, despite that, the impact on our workforce of the past mm-hmm. 3 years has been significant. And I was recently in staff governance where we reviewed our sickness absence data. So we have reasonably benchmarked sickness absence data in Grampian with the rest of Scotland. However, short-term absences have gone up, and the highest reason now for long-term absence with our workforce is anxiety, depression and stress. So the evidence is mm-hmm. there that our workforce continues to be challenged by that. And of course, it's really important for the retention factor, also the demographic of our workforce and those that will be working for longer to make the working environment the best it possibly can be, and specific pieces of work. So in Grampian, 82% of our workforce are female, and I can't remember the percentage, but a proportion of that clearly is at an age where they are experiencing menopausal symptoms. So we have had an amazing response to our Menopause Awareness Week, and the uptake of over 2,500 employees around understanding what we can offer. So it's about responding to our workforce and continually listening for those that are here just now, but also to make sure that for those that are considering coming into work in the health and care sector, it's seen as somewhere where they will be looked after too.
So Caroline's very much preempted my next question about an assessment of sickness rate across the workforce, and I wonder if the other two boards could comment on their sickness rates. But what action is being taken to support people for their return to work? There's a lot of focus on reducing vacancy rates, and I'm concerned about the pressure that then puts on staff to feel like they have to come back. There's always a willingness for staff across the NHS to come back and feel like they're not passing pressure to other colleagues, knowing what they've been through in the last few years. And if you could particularly comment on, you've all mentioned counselling and mental health support in particular. Often in some organisations, there's quite a short-term nature in terms of those counselling sessions. Is that something that is limited within each of your boards, or is it a more long-term approach?
So, in Lothian at the end of March, our sickness absence figures was 5.86%. That's made up of about 3.2%, which is short term, and 2.65%, which is longer term. It breaks down about 86% is to do with physical health, 14% for mental health, that's the short term. Longer term, 65% physical, 35% mental health. So, you're questions well asked. We've invested, we're piloting using our psychological therapies, working with our occupational health service to try and do that. It's been very successful. We believe it's been successful. The reason I'm saying that is how heavily it's used. We are doing a full evaluation of it. We have agreed to fund it again for another year, again funded through the Lothian charity. But if that evaluation comes out positive, we'll be looking to bring that in as part of our core occupational health service.
And just to build on that, I won't repeat what colleagues have said. We currently have an absence of around 6.7%. I don't have the breakdown in front of me in terms of short and long-term absence, but it'll be very similar to colleagues elsewhere. And again, the most common cause is the anxiety stress related. I think what's important is to acknowledge that's not necessarily work-related. And it's difficult to get that level of granularity. But we do need to look at staff members holistically. And what we are working with, actually, with our trade unions, we're wanting to do a real sort of tailored focus on, are we providing the right support at the right time for a particular individual? So it's not one size fits all. So some members of staff will welcome and seek and ask for the counselling and spiritual care support and other maybe some of the softer skills For others, it may not be appropriate. Mm-hmm. So we're looking to tailor that appropriately. And it is very much linked to our ageing workforce as well. And then the other area that we're looking at, and it's been topical this week, is just the range of support that's available for staff who have long COVID as well. And it's obviously a complex issue across the wider population, but very much echo what colleagues have said around the actions being taken. But there's always more we can do.
That's great. Thanks.
And Carol Mawkin has a supplementary on this.
Thank you. It's something that's been raised with me on a couple of occasions by staff, long-term staff who've worked in core services. And they've mentioned to me that some of the challenges they face in within their teams is around the way in which more modern funding streams happen. So perhaps specific pieces of work have been undertaken funding for that, and so it drains some of the really experienced nursing staff in particular out into specialties which are then, you know, fixed. And so the core teams struggle sometimes with experienced staffing, which has a knock-on effect in supporting, you know, new staff coming through. I just wondered if it was something that you recognised in your own services or if there's any particular areas that seems to be happening.
I can't think of a particular example. What I would say, though, is when we're talking about workforce is a problem for us. We quoted the sickness absence figures. But there's something I do think we need to look at. My background historically was a nurse. So when I trained originally as a nurse, it was an apprenticeship model. I worked in the wards as a nurse. And I think we need to go back to say, do you really need to go to university full-time to become a nurse? I'm not against degrees, honours degrees, etc. But you can effectively train nurses. And especially when we've got an agenda for change with bands 2, 3s, 4s. And Lothian's been very successful at what we would call modern apprenticeships. Using that approach, certainly on our mental health side, we had over 100 applicants for 20 jobs over the last 2 years. We're going to pilot it this year for registered nursing, where they're much more present in the ward through an apprenticeship model, but they're not eligible for modern apprenticeship monies. So I think if we were to have an ask of it, it would be to rethink some of that element, because I do think a lot of people find it difficult to give up a job to go to university for 3+ years, whereas they could be in employment using an apprenticeship model, and that would help our workforce. And that way they also come in a bit more experienced, more hands-on than if it's a more academic programme. I think there's certainly a place for academia. I'm not diminishing that, but I think trying to get a balance could be better.
Yeah, so I would recognise what you're saying, and I think there's so very often priorities will come up, and I've mentioned already short-term funding, and actually for the individuals that take up those posts, it's a great opportunity. It's a great opportunity to do something different, and to gain more experience in a different area. And obviously these short-term priorities are a priority, and so it's great that we can get those posts filled. But to Callum's point, without a different pipeline or redesign of our workforce, all we're doing is moving people around the system, and we are leaving gaps. And it will be no surprise that there are some specialties that are perceived to be harder work than others and are more attractive to go into. And people have the ability, because of our workforce vacancies, to choose, which again is quite right, where they go. So I think there is something about the redesign of our workforce. Callum's given one example around nursing. I know certainly in Grampian I've been asked about apprentice models within allied healthcare professionals. And how do we create career pathways for people that give them that portfolio approach, if you like, to their career, but means that we've got the right number of colleagues coming through, that we'll have reduced vacancies. So I recognise what you're saying, and I think there's a number of ways that we're trying to deal with it.
That's helpful, thank you.
Yeah, and absolutely, I recognise the points that colleagues have made, and looking at alternative roles, alternative pathways, and I guess the expression earn as you learn, which is maybe picking up on Callum's point. So really supporting a number of staff to come into the organisation or existing members of staff to undertake academic studies whilst working and supporting them through that in a very different way. Also focusing on apprenticeships and youth employment initiatives as well. And we've seen some of that coming through different roles during the pandemic. We had a member of staff who we've actually used as an example within our strategy, which is similar to colleagues, has got a strong theme around staff wellbeing and recruitment. And a member of staff who was furloughed from a media job during the pandemic joined us as a support officer in a vaccination clinic, was encouraged by the staff there to join the nurse bank, and is now a student nurse undertaking mental health nursing. You know, so it's a fantastic example of the wider role of the NHS as an anchor institution as well, but looking at career pathways in a different from a different perspective as well.
Thank you, that was very helpful, thank you.
And thanks. Emma Harper has a supplementary.
Just a wee quick sup. When I did my nurse training, there was 2 intakes a year, and so that meant that there was, you know, entry-level nurses and more experienced nurses in training, working together. Is that something that we should be thinking about again, is to help peer support, mentoring, because then you've got students at different levels in the classrooms as then on site. Is that something that we should be looking at as well?
I would certainly be very supportive of that. I think it stops this at a famine and feast, where it's very good when the new students come out, but it's once a year. And I think if we could level that out in any way, 2 intakes a year would be a good way of doing that. I think it's very supportive.
I'm happy just to add a bit to that. So I remain a registered nurse, and my role prior to this was the nurse director in Grampian, and it was a very live debate that went on between our academic partners and service in relation to the pros and cons around that model. I don't think we'll ever land on one view, but recognise Callum's viewpoint around that. I think along with the intake, whether that is one or output, whether that is 1 or 2, we need to consider the attrition rates and the uptake rates within the nursing profession in regards to the number of places that are within each academic institution and the growing gap in the uptake of those places. So it would be one part of the picture from my perspective.
Can I ask another wee sup?
If it's very short, because we've still got another theme to cover.
Okay, sorry. Okay, you mentioned earlier about paediatric anaesthetists, consultants, and so they might have to work in one NHS board in order to achieve certain competency or skills. Is it easy for an anaesthetist to work cross-board as far as competency, inclusion, or do they have to do the whole infection prevention control and fire safety and move and handling no matter where they are?
So my experience is that doctors in training and the if a doctor in training who wishes to specialise in paediatric anaesthesia, they will work across, they may come to the north and they may get all of their places within Grampian, or they may go across other boards, and their, I will need to double check this, but their training is partly with NHS, as in their statutory and mandatory, so health and safety, infection prevention controls. They will do components of that through NHS, which should be consistent with TURAS, and there will be specifics that they have to do within each board. I think the reality for substantive consultants and trained doctors working across boards is more complex, and you've highlighted one aspect of that, which is the governance around our induction and different policies and local boards to keep clinicians and patients safe. Mm-hmm. So I think there is improvement that we could do around that.
Okay, thanks. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. And I'm going to move to Carol Mulkin for our final theme.
Thank you, convener. just for the last theme, I'm interested in dignity at work. We no longer do the survey, so I just wondered if each of the health boards could feedback how they feel they make sure they do, make sure staff have that ability to feed into the system, how they think, you know, the overall trend in their boards are, and in terms of staff governance, how you monitor that and then go on to make sure changes happen should they need to.
I'm happy to go with that one. So we have a range of opportunities for colleagues to raise concerns. Of course, we would hope that that doesn't happen, but the reality of large organisations is there are always going to be different perspectives. And so it's critically important that we do create the opportunity for people to feel safe, whether that's in escalating concerns to their line manager and having that level of mediation or discussion, or whether that goes through into more formal human resource investigations, etc. So I think I've mentioned already that we have contacts, confidential contacts within the organisation. We have, well, everyone has whistleblowing as an opportunity, if that's the route that people choose to take. We have our HR processes and very strong and positive working relationships with our staff side colleagues. And I've mentioned other things that we do around raising concerns as early as possible, so trickle apps, or we have a range of question and answer sessions. And we have we're working on our culture and creating the psychological safety for people to challenge poor behaviour when we see it in action, and supporting colleagues with education and training to give them confidence to do that. So our evidence of that and how we monitor that is indeed through our staff governance committee. We also have our advisory clinical networks that feed in, and our Grampian Area Partnership Forum. So we have... in relation to the overall reports, we've just had our whistleblowing report, which we considered in committee, and specifically a breakdown of our bullying and harassment cases. And I am just trying to find the figures on that, but I think within this year we've had 3 cases that have been identified as being escalated by staff, been taken through formal process and are under investigation. So that would be our governance processes around that.
Can I ask, on the whistleblowing, are you confident people are well supported and feel that they would do that should it be necessary?
So specifically for us, as I say, we've just had our report considered at committee, and the feedback that we had from, because we interview every person that has raised a whistleblowing case, and so the feedback that we have had is that colleagues who raised concerns fed back they felt listened to and well supported during the process. And that is because we have that process in place to do an appraisal of each case individually.
Thank you.
Can maybe add to that? So very similar to Caroline has mentioned around governance through staff governance committee and the reporting through that route. We're also just introducing through our board on a bi-monthly basis, we're going to be introducing staff stories as part of the introduction at board meeting as well, to give that that increased focus. So culture, how staff are feeling, whether they're feeling listened to, is given the highest level of attention amongst the executive team within Fife, but also at board level. We have similar initiatives through the whistleblowing processes. We have Know Who to Talk To. We have a talking toolkit that we're rolling out as well. We've had a very small number of whistleblowing cases, and that makes me slightly curious, because it makes me want to dig a little bit deeper to just ensure that is the culture through the organisation how we would hope it would be at all levels and in all teams, and is there more that we can do? We have a range of ways in which, I guess, we approach all of this. So I certainly have emphasised the importance of visible leadership, and I know my colleagues will as well. So I personally do regular walkabouts with the employee director within our health and social care partnership. The director alongside staff side representatives do the same, likewise within our acute setting. So that visibility of leadership and giving staff sharing information, written updates. We have mentioned earlier on the Team Fife, that sense of belonging. There's a real focus and concerted effort on that across the organisation, and we would hope that that would develop and nurture the culture that we would be hoping for within the organisation. But as I say, it's a real priority for us. But again, always more we can learn. And I'm when we leave the room, I'm going to speak to Caroline about Trickle, because I would like to hear more about the app.
Thank you. Carol.
Yeah, it's similar. We've got a small number of whistleblowing cases. They're always dealt with as best we can. We do have speak up ambassadors who try to take people through the process. The governance structure is the same as colleagues have outlined through the Staff Governance Committee. Certainly myself and the employee director both co-chair the partnership forum, and all the other partnership forums link into that. I think one of the things I would cite, though, is we are finding a lot of our staff are coming back. We're finding about 25% of our staff retire and return now, certainly okay. Nursing, and I think that's a good indicator. We do also have supportive staff networks, and some of those networks, like our BME network, are driven by our staff, and that's to provide peer support there, and I'm a big advocate of those, so they're there to support the staff throughout. So I think it's one of these things that you're never going to be finished with. It's like the fourth road bridge. You're going to have to keep going round it. But I don't think we always get it right, but we do try to get it right.
Thank you. Thanks, convener.
Thank you very much. Can I thank the panel for their attendance today for your time. And we will have a short break while we change over to the next panel of witnesses. Thank you. The next item on our agenda is the final oral evidence session as part of our inquiry into female participation in sport and physical activity. A welcome to the committee, Marie Todd, Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport, and Andrew Sinclair, Head of Active Scotland, Scottish Government. And we're going to move straight to questions. So can I ask, Minister, what progress has been made towards introducing a national approach to increasing female participation in sport leadership and governance, as recommended by the Levelling the Playing Field report?
So there's actually been a great deal of progress over the years. I'm very pleased to that recent data from the Scottish Health Survey shows a significant 4 percentage point increase for women in meeting UK Chief Medical Officer's recommended levels of activity. So it's gone from 61% up to 65%. The gap between levels of participation between men and women are closing. But whilst we are delighted that things are headed in the right direction, I don't think any of us here would want to be complacent, and we have to continue to work to improve that situation. In terms of leadership, there's been some brilliant successes, particularly with younger women taking up opportunities for leadership in sport. Again, really delighted to see that progress, but we can't be complacent. We know that when it comes to sports governing bodies and the organisation of sport in general, whilst we are seeing more female athletes participating in sport, we're not seeing female participation reflected in the boardroom, and nor are we probably seeing the level of participation we'd like to see in the sort of governance of sports, so in terms of officials and things like that. So we've more work to do, but we have some good things to report.
Things that you've reflected, the Minister, were issues and concerns that were raised by various stakeholders about women's traditional role in caregiving and how that can become a barrier for them to be able to become coaches or participate in the governance in sport. One of the other areas that the committee has touched on is how women's sport is portrayed in the media, and actually the lack of reporting in print, on TV, with some exceptions. And I fully accept that there has been some improvement, particularly in women's football in terms of broadcasting. So in the 2021-22 programme for government, a Scottish sports media summit was promised, and I wonder if perhaps you'd be able to give us an update on what's happening with that and how the government is trying to help to promote women's sport to a wider audience, which realistically is through the media or through social media.
So certainly you'll be aware that between the pandemic and also the challenges we faced in balancing the budget last year, some tough decisions were made, and we didn't progress with some work that we had intended to do. It's still our aim to hold a media summit and to try to challenge some of the reporting around female participation in sport. There are challenges. I mean, football probably, I mean, it's our national sport and everybody loves it, the national game, but it probably gets more coverage than almost all of the other sports put together. Mm-hmm. And I think you heard some of that in your evidence. So the fact that women are playing football and playing football successfully now means they are gaining some coverage, but that doesn't help to celebrate the successes of, and I know you had an athlete who was involved in judo giving evidence early. So it doesn't help with, for example, giving her sport the profile that it deserves. And let me tell you, we are very successful at judo in Scotland. We have some fantastic female athletes participating. So there's real challenges. I think there is a cultural change afoot. I think there has been some, particularly with broadcast media, I have to credit BBC Alaba for the work that they've done in terms of bringing women's sport to television. It's phenomenally important. I mean, we have a women and girls sport in women and girls in sport week every year. Mm-hmm. And the thing that we are told every time is just how important it is for people to see the roles they want to be. They can't be it if they can't
see it, and it's just vitally important. But I mean, I'm somebody who's absolutely passionate about sport. I haven't found a sport yet I don't like. I would like to see coverage of more diversity of sports and absolutely celebration of those female athletes whose, you know, are challenging some of the stereotypes that are there in society. I mean, sometimes, you know, I'm a passionate rugby fan. When I see some of the social media films that they bring out about the women's rugby team, the Scottish women's rugby team, where they're lifting weights and really strong physical role models, that busts a myth about women in general, doesn't it? And I think it's really important that more people see those things.
Thank you. And finally, on this in this particular theme, I wonder if any decisions have been made regarding the future of the Women and Girls in Sport Advisory Board, and if that board were to be dissolved, what would take its place and how would the Scottish Government continue to progress towards gender equality in sport?
So I think they've had some great contributions to make, and there's absolutely some phenomenal leaders and glass ceiling busters in that group, let me say. If I think about, I think Dee Bradbury's in that group, isn't she? So there's a tier one nation, female president of a tier one nation in rugby, which has not been replicated in the rest of the world. Scotland has some very powerful leadership roles who are in that collective. In terms of the future, I don't know if you want to say more about the future of that group, Andy.
Yeah, so the group went into slight hibernation during COVID, as much of our work did. However, they made some clear recommendations before COVID hit. And again, we are taking those recommendations forward at the moment. And again, the media summit that the Minister mentioned, again, there's been some great progress around broadcast and women's sport. We've seen a number of highlights. We've seen the Scotland national women's team move to Hampden. We've seen record crowds at SWPL games, record crowds at Women's Six Nations, live netball coverage of the Scottish netball team. However, I think print media is still an issue. I think the column inches that women's sports get is not good enough. And often the women's stories focus on not their sporting performance, something in their private life, you know, what they've been up to, who they're married to, that kind of thing. So I think changing that dial is what we're looking to achieve through that media summit, which we hope to have by the end of this year, hopefully.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm now going to move to Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Good morning, Andrew. We know that socioeconomic status is the biggest factor in whether people are involved in physical activity. But how can we ensure that funding is used where it's most needed and inequalities aren't further entrenched?
So that's a real focus for the government, and we've committed this term of Parliament to double the funding for sport and physical activity, and we are determined to focus that extra funding on tackling inequalities. You're absolutely right that there is at the moment a pre-existing inequality across the board for participation. So football, again, to give them credit as our national game, is the one sport where there is equal participation across all the socioeconomic groups. Every other sport favours the wealthy. So there is a socioeconomic divide for literally every other sport. How do we tackle that? How do we improve that? Well, we're speaking to all the sports governing bodies about that. There's some amazing programmes in place. So, for example, Scottish Athletics are doing some great work going into communities where they wouldn't normally be operating, targeting those groups who may not naturally be participating in athletics. And that is gaining them participants from those particular areas of socioeconomic deprivation. It's also gaining them a more ethnically diverse participant group. So there's some specific work that can go on. I think that you know, the socioeconomic thing shouldn't be ignored. That may be one of the reasons, because, you know, why women experience inequalities generally, because of their inequality in wealth, inequality in power, inequality in status. So
you know, I used to talk about women experiencing health inequalities when I was Women's Health Minister. That's one of the reasons why they experience inequalities in health, in sport as well, because they don't have as much money as men. What can we do? One of the things, basics that we can do is encourage those sports where money doesn't matter. So things like participation in the Daily Mile, being integral and part of the school day in Scotland is a really important way to target absolutely everyone, so boys and girls can participate in the same way. There's no economic barriers to participating in that activity every day. And, you know, we've got, I think, 1,000 schools participating, but it's still only, and it's 32 local authority areas, so really, really good, but it's still only about half the children in Scotland. About half the children aren't doing the Daily Mile. And the Daily Mile will, you know, it's just 15 minutes of exercise three times a week. I do my Daily Mile every day, let me be clear. But the recommendation is 15 minutes of exercise three times a week. And for that, you get such a bang for your buck. You get measurable improvements in children's fitness, decrease in BMI, decrease in body fat. So you get all the physical changes, but you also get the cognitive changes. They are more able to learn. They are more confident. They are happier. They are calmer. They're actually, you know, so the mood impacts and the cognitive impacts are huge for a very small investment in time and no money. It's about the most inclusive programme we have for exercise in Scotland, and we're pretty keen to expand it further. You know, I think everyone should do their Daily Mile.
And I assume at the present time, Minister, that it's very important given we're living through a cost of living crisis.
Absolutely. So, you know, there are many barriers to participation in sport, needing kit and equipment. And again, I think you heard that not all sports are equal. So cricket, for example, I looked at the evidence that you were given by that young female cricketer, and she was saying because of the equipment that's required for her sport, it does tend to attract people who are from a wealthier socioeconomic background. So there are many barriers to getting involved, and we as a government want to bust as many of those as we can. I mean, one of the great programmes, and there are so many brilliant programmes, Scottish Sport Futures collaborated with Sweaty Betty, you know, and they're actually a luxury brand of sportswear. So they provided hundreds and hundreds of bras so that young women who might have been prevented from getting involved in sport and physical activity had the equipment. I mean, a sports bra is a really expensive acquisition. You know, it can be £30 to £60 to buy one decent sports bra. That is an absolute barrier for many people, many young people, to get involved in sport. So that collaboration is really phenomenal. I mean, I love it that these young, that particular young group of women were getting the most luxury brand you could possibly imagine. But it was, you know, I visited, they came up and met me in Inverness, and we did some sport and exercise together. And I just thought it's a fantastic way to open the conversation about what the barriers might be. Now, needing specialist kit isn't the only barrier to participating in sport. Those young women spoke to me, as you have heard throughout this inquiry, about the challenges of being involved with sport while you're menstruating, the challenges of just the general society pressure to look a certain way, to behave a certain way, the fact that women's bodies and young women's bodies are pretty, I would say, past commentable is the phrase I would use. So they face a lot of commentary when they do get involved. So kit and money isn't the only barrier, but it's certainly a significant one. And just now, in a cost of living crisis, it is absolutely the difference between some women being able to exercise and some women not.
Okay. And I know the Scottish Government is looking at maybe restricting alcohol advertising. How are you going to do that, but still make sure that it doesn't negatively affect funding for sport?
It's really challenging, isn't it? And I think that's a really excellent question. So I am somebody who is absolutely passionate about sport. I want sport to be well funded, but I want sport to be healthy, and I want sport to be inclusive. And the two groups that we have found who are particularly vulnerable to the sort of sport sponsorship and advertising of alcohol are children, who there was a very dismaying study a couple of years ago that looked at the Calcutta Cup, I think it was in 2020, and saw that children watching that on television saw an alcohol prompt every 12 seconds as they watched that match. But the other group who are particularly affected are people who are in recovery, and they are particularly susceptible to sports advertising. I believe we can strike a balance. I think we have to start from a place where we acknowledge how much alcohol harm there still is in Scotland. So over 1,000 people a year die of alcohol in Scotland. I think it's 24 people per week die of drinking alcohol in Scotland. It is something that, although we have made progress in recent years, it is absolutely essential that we continue to make progress. And these aren't, you know, there's a perception that the people who are dying of alcohol are a distinct group that you can somehow target with your intervention. And there's some truth in that. There's no doubt that the socioeconomic divide appears here as well. And if you are living in poverty and drinking excessively, you are more likely to die than somebody who is wealthy and drinking excessively. But alcohol and alcohol misuse and harm from alcohol really does no bounds. And we've seen that over the course of just this weekend, where a couple of colleagues have spoken up, Miles Briggs and Monica Lennon, both of whom lost parents to alcohol, who've spoken very powerfully about the stigma of alcohol dependence and misuse. And I think how important it is for us to have these conversations about what we can do at a population level that would shift the curve somewhat, so that fewer people are finding themselves in the situation where they are drinking hazardously. And I think that a discussion around sport sponsorship and sports promotion and advertising is a really important part of that national conversation.
May I just add something as well, bringing it back to women's sport? Obviously, the Scottish women's football have made a conscious decision and commitment to only engage in ethical sponsorship, so avoiding alcohol, avoiding gambling firms. So again, it's a good model, you know, and it brings us back to the inquiry today. I think it can be done, but I accept that there's a fairly small pool that Scottish sport is fishing in terms of sponsorship.
Thank you.
I just make a small plea then to the Scottish Government, if they are looking at reducing alcohol sponsorship, that they take some lessons from what's happened in Ireland, where there have been alcohol advertising banned. However, some companies appear to be trying to get around those rules by advertising low or no alcohol products which share same or similar names, so they're still getting that brand recognition. Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and good morning, Andrew, as well. It's just to pick up on Evelyn Tweed's questions about alcohol and alcohol advertising. You know, there's two big soft drinks companies. One of them supports the Olympics, and the other one seems to be in about all the mountain biking in America. And whether it's soapbox racing or mountain biking, it's a lot of money that helps support sponsorship for sport. But I've been approached by other people that say that these are health-harming products, and so we have to consider that when we're supporting sponsorship or advertising or helping get young women or young anybody into sport. So how do you feel about, you know, implementing restrictions on advertising for other products that are not just alcohol-related that might be soft drinks?
So I think it's challenging. There's precedent in that area, in that I think tobacco
or certainly smoking advertising has been restricted. And in fact, I think it was Billy, I had the absolute privilege of meeting Billie Jean King last year, who talked about the Virginia Masters, which used to be a big tennis tournament in America, which was sponsored by the cigarette company, Virginia. So we have made strides in reducing tobacco and smoking's appearance in sport. I recognise, unusually in Scotland we have a sports minister who is part of the health department, so I'm a junior health minister. I absolutely recognise the health benefits of sport and physical activity. That's not just for your physical health, it's for your mental health too, which I'm sure we'll get onto. And I think it's really important that we remember that when we are considering how we fund sport. The challenge is getting that balance correct. And as Andy has said, you know, there is a relatively small pool for companies to fish in terms of getting access to sponsorship within Scotland. I think it is important that we consider these issues. And I think it's really, particularly for those groups who I said we are aware are particularly susceptible to advertising, which would be young people and people in recovery.
And just a final question, and I know we're going to come on to children and young people, but I'm interested in evidence that we took last week. Basically, there was a plea for our review of the National Performance Framework to include specific outcomes related to physical, mental and social benefits of sport and physical activity. Would the government consider making a specific target or as part of the National Performance Framework for that? Is that something that would help then refocus or focus further the importance of physical activity and sport for physical and mental health and wellbeing?
Well, certainly I try to make that link all the time when I'm talking and very regularly talk about sport and its benefit for physical health, mental health and social health. I think there's a general population level recognition of the benefits of physical activity and sport for social health since the pandemic, when we were all restricted from participating and found ourselves, you know, walking outdoors to socialise because it was the safest way to do it. I would absolutely love it if Scotland became a nation that socialises through exercise. Andy, I don't know if you want to come in on the national outcomes particular.
So physical activity does feature. So obviously the NPF talks about being healthy and active. So I feel that we're quite well represented in that space. We also have the Active Scotland Outcomes Framework, which sits below that, which talks about our whole systems approach to physical activity and how we implement things in Scotland. And again, that's recognised by the World Health Organization as an exemplar, actually. And again, probably part of the reason why we're bucking global trends in terms of getting people more active in Scotland.
Mm-hmm. OK, thank you. Thanks.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you very much, Convener. Thank you, Minister. One of the things that came out quite strongly in a previous evidence session was that around 90% of funding for sport in Scotland is channelled through local authorities. So it's quite a highly disseminated model of funding. And of that, councils are faced with, you know, 80% central government allocations, 20% through council tax and charges. So there is a bit of pressure, to say the least, on council finances. And often the first things to go are what are seen as non-statutory service provisions, so the focus would be on things like social work, education. Things like sport are seen as potentially less severe, you know, options when they're looking at making savings or cuts. What's your assessment of the impact on council finances on the provision of sport, particularly focused on provision for women and girls and that kind of specific facilities, and what can you do to sort of try and ameliorate that impact?
So I think everyone would acknowledge that we're in challenging financial times right at the moment. And I think it's challenging for central government, for Scottish government, it's challenging for local government as well. We all
And it, you know, this particular financial or cost crisis has come on the back of over a decade of austerity politics, which has had an impact on our public services, undoubtedly, over the course of more than 10 years. So it's a challenging situation that we face. We are, the Scottish Government have not just maintained funding to local government, but we have increased it in real terms. And we are very keen to continue to prioritise local government spending in our budgeting. We recognise how challenging it is, and we're all hearing it in the press at the moment, particularly, you know, there's a small number of local authorities around Scotland where they're making decisions on closures of particular individual facilities. We had a debate in Parliament just last week about Perth and Kinross, about the challenging situation that they faced with regard to maintaining Dewars. Thankfully, they have managed to maintain the funding for the Dewars facility, and it is secure for the next few months. We're working day in, day out with local government colleagues to try to rise and meet this challenge and to see what we can do to support them. I think much of the current challenge is being precipitated by energy costs. So it's the energy-dense sports that you're seeing particularly struggling. So things like swimming pools and ice rinks. Again, you know, continuing to put pressure on the UK government that has many of the levers over the cost of energy is an important strand to try to tackle that particular challenge. But in the short term, it's challenging. Medium term and long term, I think there's work that we can do together to try to improve the estate so that it is less, so there's less energy consumption going on with these facilities. But that's not an overnight fix. That's something we have to do. We have to make that transition anyway in order to meet our net zero targets. But that's something the government's more than happy to work alongside local government with.
I know there's a contested space around real terms cuts from COSLA, etc. I don't want to get into that sort of debate, though. I think the focus really is on what can we do to highlight risks in the estate that you mentioned, for example. So could it be around things like investment in district heating networks? Could it be capital investments that are targeted? Where councils are making decisions where there is a risk to the future provision of sport facilities in Scotland, is there a mechanism by which that can be flagged as a risk and then potential mitigating measures are looked at with the government around things like capital investments or targeted investments? Could there be opportunities to look at where there's best practice and other authorities, whether they've been able to crowd in maybe some sort of external investment, or whether there's sponsorship, or whether there's some entrepreneurial activity which has ameliorated the impact? I'm just wondering whether there is potential for a more developed ecosystem, if you like, of feedback between local government dealing with challenging situations on the ground versus, you know, sharing that best practice, sharing things that have worked better, and then potentially where you say, for example, swimming pools, you know, highly energy intensive assets, could there be ways of investing capital into those to reduce the revenue costs, for example? Is there potential for developing something there?
So we're doing quite a lot of work in that space already, and Andy will probably want to come in and tell you a little bit more about the work that Sport Scotland are doing with local authority colleagues on the sporting estate nationally, and trying to take that strategic view about where investment will have the most impact. I mean, I would say we're working very closely with our local authority colleagues on this. I absolutely empathise how tough a situation they are in. We are in a tough situation too, and difficult decisions are being made going forward. It is a difficult, really difficult time to be in politics. So we have very open and candid channels of communication and support available. What we don't have is a limitless pot of money to help out in these situations. And I think that's challenging for all of us. There aren't easy short-term solutions in the situation that we face. Longer term, we can certainly work to get the estate onto a better footing, though.
Thanks.
So again, to give some comfort, we do speak regularly with local authorities and Community Leisure UK, who are the umbrella body for leisure trusts. to understand the position and recognise that it's incredibly challenging. As the Minister mentioned, Sport Scotland are at the start of commencing a full facilities review for Scotland to understand the state of the condition of the estate in terms of physical activity infrastructure. And again, the pressure on local authorities kind of means three things that they need to think about doing. That could be reducing opening hours to cut costs, putting up prices for people. And again, we've spoken about the challenges that would present in terms of inequalities and also closing facilities. And again, there will be cases where, and again, swimming pools is a prime example. Swimming pools that were built in the 70s will never be energy efficient. And again, if a local authority does a proper consultation process, and again, there are facilities that could be used in a different way. And again, as we know, local authorities have a requirement to provide adequate facilities. That's the only requirement on local authorities. And again, there's no clear definition on what adequate means. So again, as long as there's genuine engagement with local authorities and the people that live in those areas, you know, hopefully they can come up with a solution.
Thank you. When we had our witnesses in last week, Kim Atkinson queried how local authorities are held accountable for their investment in sport, given that, as Paul Sweeney says, it's quite a substantial amount of money that is put out by Scottish Government for sport goes through local authorities. I've seen the price increases in my own area, which caused huge outcry, 114% increase for children and young people in terms of changing the discount that they had to access sporting facilities. So I'm wondering, I appreciate that we want local authorities to be as autonomous as possible, and it is a very fine line that Scottish Government walks on this, but given that the impact that some of these price increases and closures may have on particularly children and young people, is there more that the Scottish Government can do in terms of ensuring that money actually gets to where it should be going?
I mean, I think it's a really difficult, challenging area that, you know, local government are democratically accountable to the populations that they serve, and it's not Scottish Government's role to oversee their spending decisions. There has to be locally accountable decision making, and you know, Paul Sweeney mentioned just how much of the budget is already ring fenced. I think ring fencing more of it wouldn't be welcome. I mean, I think over the course, if I'm honest, I think over the course of the pandemic, we've worked really closely together with local authority partners. We rose to face that incredibly challenging time for our nation together. We navigated the challenges together. I think that there is a keenness on both sides, between both Scottish Government and COSLA, to try to continue that positive working relationship. And whilst nobody, you know, everybody acknowledges that there will be, you know, challenging decisions that are made on either side, where, you know, local authorities might contest some of the spending decisions we make. We may also contest some of the spending decisions that they make. There is absolutely room for respect on both sides and working together on both sides to try to collaboratively find a way forward in this really, really challenging time.
Thank you. I'm now going to move to James Dornan, who's joining us remotely.
Thank you very much, convener. Good morning, Minister and Andrew. It's 10 years since Maureen McGonigal, Alison Walker and myself began Scottish Women in Sport under the leadership, of course, of Maureen McGonigal. And one of the things that was of real interest is at that point was how girls at a certain age dropped off in physical activity. And I'm seeing pretty much the same is still the case. I'm wondering, how do you address that drop-off? What actions can you take to ensure that girls feel safe and welcome to participate in physical activity in school play areas?
You're absolutely correct, James, that drop-off at sort of puberty is well recognised, long established, and it is a challenging one to shift. I suppose through the life course, we see a difference between... For children, we see a difference in participation. It only becomes statistically significant between the ages of 13 and 15. So it only, although boys participate more than girls, it only becomes statistically significant, that difference at puberty. And we see that difference continue right throughout life. But again, you know, it's not permanent. So girls drop off at puberty, boys drop off at puberty. They do re-engage again at future points. I think there are challenges. So at puberty, so for women and girls, you know, from a very early age, there will be expectations around caring roles. There are challenges when girls hit puberty, the changes in their body that give them... I mean, I was reflecting on my Daily Mile this morning. One of the things I was thinking about was the difference in my body confidence aged 50 compared to age 15. And I think that everyone would recognise that difference. Now, there are challenges for girls coming of age in a gendered society such as we live in at the moment. There are expectations of body confirmation. There's discomfort about menstruation. I heard an athlete this morning on the radio, a triathlete, Emma Pallant Brown, talking about a photograph that she posted of herself running with a bloodstained swimsuit. Menstruation is still taboo. Body hair is still taboo. There's all sorts of reasons why, as we hit puberty, girls stop exercising, and it is a challenging one to get into. I do think we're in a healthier space now than we've ever been in terms of the debate that's occurring, frankly, and there are particular programmes which are, you know, there are things that will help. Women and girls only spaces will help. There's in terms of communal changing spaces, women tend to have a preference for privacy. So changing the changing rooms so that it's possible for women and girls to change privately rather than in a communal space, all of these things will help, but it will take time. And there's massive societal pressure. Don't underestimate the societal pressure on women and girls to look a certain way, which we feel strongest at that sort of 11 to 15 stage of life.
Yeah, having been a grandfather of a granddaughter who's now beyond that stage, thankfully, not having to go through all those worries, but I understand what it's like at that age. But I mean, I'm talking about, it was 10 years ago when this came up as an issue for us. 10 years on, we still have almost exactly the same issues. I mean, what is it that society needs to do, that the government needs to do, that sport needs to do, education, to try and ease that burden for young women at that age?
So I suppose that I agree it's frustrating that that's been 10 years, but actually, yeah. If you think about the taboo on menstrual blood, that's been millennia that has been in place. So the idea that we could overturn some of these taboos and these challenges that women face in participation overnight is frankly wrong, I would say. I think we're having some really good conversations now. I've never known a time in my life where elite athletes are talking openly about issues like menstruation, contraception, pregnancy and sport, menopause and sport. And it is really healthy. It is really healthy that this debate is finally happening. What we've seen, in the same way as we have seen women's health understudied, we've seen women's participation in sport understudied, and the understanding of the influence that our different physiology has on performance sport and things hasn't historically been looked at. Firstly, women have participated less in sport, and secondly, we've been studied less as we are in medicine. There's a great deal more understanding going on in those issues, and Sport Scotland has some particular work in the elite in performance athlete field, which is really helpful. There's better conversations going on. There's more understanding of the barriers. There's more tackling of the barriers. But I think it would be foolish to imagine there was just one thing that unlocked sport and physical activity for women and girls. There's multiple barriers. I mean, as I said, you know, a sports bra costing £30 to £60 and being a pretty essential piece of kit is a barrier that many women and girls will not be able to overcome as they hit puberty.
Yeah, well, I look forward to a further report in the future to see how well we're getting on with this. Thank you.
Thanks, Convener. Just picking up again on the sports bra issue, I visited Wallace Hall Academy yesterday and I spoke to five young women, Mika, Fern, Zena, Michaela and Daisy. They were all six-year students or thereabouts and they all participated in rugby and running and loved all sports and they were absolutely confident and informed and empowered. But they did recognise that not all young women their age were confident and empowered to speak up about their periods or about the need for a sports bra. But one thing that they did say was that the school purchased for year one students a specific sports PE uniform. And that was a bit of an equalities and a leveller because all these kids were coming from different primary schools and it was a way to kind of engage them all at a literal level playing field. So that was something that was interesting. So I would be interested to know, Minister, if you think that we do need to look at like uniforms and availability for sports bras, for instance, and sporting uniforms as part of the uniform policy for government?
Absolutely, I think that would be a really good idea. During this Parliament, we've committed to introducing statutory guidelines for school, increasing the use of generic items of uniform and reducing the cost of the... You know, we've got a lot of focus on reducing the cost of the school day. We are consulting, or we have consulted on guidelines on school uniform and clothing. We engaged with pupils and undertook a public consultation. We're in the process of analysing that, and a report summarising the findings will be published sometime soon, I would have thought, you know, sometime pretty much around now. And the cost of school uniform and clothing and equipment for PE, physical activity and sport, does come into it. And there'll definitely be a focus on trying to reduce costs for families. So I think looking at breast care is a really important part of that. It's definitely one of the reasons why there's a drop-off in participation. I mean, there's a lot, you know, as we said, there's lots and lots of reasons, but that's one of the reasons why there's a drop-off in participation, and seeing what we can do to engage in that and to improve that situation is really important.
Okay, and one other thing that the young women raised was that sometimes the boys that they played rugby with or played sports with, or if they were in the field at the same time, the boys were a bit sexist and misogynistic. Yep. And when I mentioned to the head, the principal teacher, the Don't Be That Guy campaign, which is actually maybe a bit more hard-hitting because it is about harassment and sexual assault and sexual violence, is there, and Barry Graham, the principal, is going to take a look at Don't Be That Guy, but is there maybe a room for something maybe not as hard-hitting, but maybe a Don't Be That Guy equivalent for teenage lads as well?
So there's definitely an important area to acknowledge in that. There's a lot of gender. We live in a gender stereotyped world where, you know, girls and women are expected to look a certain way, behave a certain way, and conform to certain roles. And there is no doubt at all, as children grow up and reach puberty, and, you know, they're experimenting and finding out who their tribe is and testing out the world that they live in and exploring it. And part of that can be absolutely thinking that women's bodies are, as I say, the term I use is past commentable, you know, but it's okay to just say, you know, and we face it all the time. Each and every single female in this room will have had times where people have past commented on their appearances. I think it's particularly difficult for teenage girls, and I hear all the time about boys' comments being a barrier to their participation. I think education can help to tackle that, but we have to recognise, I mean, the same as with, you know, other societal challenges like racism, sexism, misogyny, sport reflects society. And we live in a world where these things are a reality, so there will be some of that reflected in sport. I firmly believe that sport can lead the way in changing culture. I really believe there are some positives that can that sport can lead on in terms of shifting that culture. And I think it's important that we harness the power of sport to tackle some of these societal ills, as well as looking at education in schools. We can look at role models within sport. We can look at grassroots projects that might tackle some of these issues. But I think it is really important. It is a really important part of work.
Mm-hmm. Just final question about the variety of sports. So one of the other things that came up in conversation was during the summer sporting, you know, there's shot put, javelin, there's 400 metre relay that's mixed genders, and tug of war, because not everybody wants to win a gold medal. Some folk just want to participate and actually have a bit of fun. And so that was something that this particular school, Wallace Hall Academy, have implemented. So is there something that the Scottish Government could do to maybe increase the, I suppose, the more wide variety of sports and I suppose take on board really good practice in some mm-hmm. schools and, you know, get everybody not just competing but participating as well?
So I think, I mean, I'll let Andy speak a little bit about this as well, but there's always that tension, isn't there? There's a difference between elite sport and social sport and recreational sport. And actually, as a government, we want to encourage participation right across the board. We want everyone, I mean, I could sing the praises of sport morning, noon and night in terms of the benefits for your physical health, mental health and social health. We want everyone to have access to that. If it were a pill, it would be worth billions, wouldn't it? So we want to increase participation. One of the ways to increase participation is to take away barriers. One of the things is to offer a diversity of experience. So that's a diversity of different sports. But also, you know, sometimes people, exactly, and there may be a gender difference in this, although I'm not totally sure, sometimes it's a perception there's a gender difference in this, but there might be different levels of appetite for competition, and there are definitely occasions where just participating for the joy of it is really important. Now, gymnastics, actually, Scottish gymnastics see themselves as very much a feeder for all other sports. So they're particularly participating girls, you know, it's particularly gendered participation. Very, very high number of girls and women participate in that sport. They very often go on to other sports, and gymnastics is where they gain their physical literacy. Only a small number of people participating in gymnastics go on to compete as gymnasts, but they are very often using the skills that they picked up as youngsters in that sport, in other sports going forward. There are different, you know, I think that sports, we need to think about, you know, I mean, we watched the Olympics with a lot of interest. The last time it was on, there was really brand new cycling events, which really captured the imagination of the world, the BMX events and things. I think there's really exciting innovations happening in sport. There are new kinds of competition coming along. We're going to host the UCI Worlds in Scotland this year. I can't wait to see football on a bike and gymnastics on a bike. You know, I think there's really interesting innovations going on. But I suppose what I'm saying is we need to think. I passionately believe there's a sport out there for everyone. I personally, I mean, I joke I got into rugby because I was a bit clumsy and I did bang into people and fall over quite easily. And I found a sport where those assets, those characteristics were an asset to me. I admittedly have always participated in social sports. I was never going to be an elite athlete. I trained hard and I played hard, but it was only ever going to be a social or recreational experience for me. I think that everybody should have that. When I reflect, you know, when I was talking this morning about my Daily Mile and reflecting on that journey to body confidence that I have now as a 50-year-old, participating in rugby was a big part of that. Recognising that my body could do things that I, you know, never imagined it could do. It was really strong. I could knock down people who were much faster than me. I could be, you know, and just that recognising that there are sports out there with a role for every single body shape. It's really powerful stuff. Really powerful stuff. So we need to broaden everyone's horizons. We need to get everyone participating, give them loads of opportunities. I was at, I think a number of you might have been at the 150th celebration of football in Parliament last week, where we heard from Sam Milne, who talked about starting a recreational football group. And a lassie, she talked about a particular individual, Farah McKenzie, who had come along. So recreational football's not competitive at all, it's just social. Women come along and they play together, and they talked so powerfully about the camaraderie that gave them, the social benefits, but also the physical health benefits and the mental health benefits. I mean, Farah spoke about losing, I think she said, 6 stone in weight. She had been a type 2 diabetic who was on the brink of going on to insulin, and participating in recreational football pushed all that back for her. So my thing would be, let's make sure there are as many opportunities for absolutely everybody to participate in sport and physical activity. We do need some competitive opportunities. I'm not dismissing the elite athletes amongst us. They need competition. They were saying about that recreational football that even they, some of them, were beginning to enjoy having competition. They were gathering together to have recreational football games once a month now, so there is that opportunity for competition. But I want participation. I want us to move more. I want us to enjoy our bodies. I want us to be fitter, stronger physically, mentally, and get all the social benefit that it brings.
Thank you.
I would just add to that. We also have around 200 community sport hubs across the country, and again, many of which are based in schools, and again, they offer a range of activities. And again, sports have become really good over the last few years at sharing participants. There's not really as much competition between sports. So if football's not for you, a badminton club's also housed here. You could try that. So again, it's giving young people in particular a range of activities to try out, which again is really positive. And just as an aside, Tug of War is actually our smallest governing body in Scotland that we invest into. So they do some good work.
I think one of the other things that's happened is that Active Schools coordinators are really good at collaborating with the assets that are in the community already. So making those links between the sports clubs in each local area. I mean, I know your part of the country, they're big on curling and ice sports. In my part of the country, they're very big on shinty. So trying to make those links with the sport that is already happening in the community to give children and young people opportunities to join with assets that are already there. I think that's an important part of getting it right.
And the curling is also good for people in wheelchairs as well.
Oh, the curling is just spectacular. I had the most marvellous visit to Inverness Ice Rink, where I met a group of curlers. I mean, it nearly finished me off curling. I have to remember, I said I was a bit clumsy. I didn't find it easy, but oh my goodness, what a supportive bunch. And there were so many of them with stories to tell. Some had participated lifelong in the sport. Some had come to it very late, so it seemed to be a sport that was really easy for particularly older women to get involved with. A couple of women there spoke about having been widowed and friends invited them along, and it just became, it's an unbelievably social sport, and the advantages of that are endless. But oh my goodness, those women were pretty competitive as well. So you get the all the advantages, and it was a workout. I was sore for days afterwards.
Thanks.
Yeah, thank you. We're going to move on to our next theme, and I'm going to bring in Carol Malkin.
Thank you, convener. We've touched a wee bit on community sport already with the Leisure Centre. discussion. I'm interested in some of the questions that we were asked from our other witnesses, and it really is about trying to engage women, but the themes that come through that are difficult, and there's three things. Safety around going to and from venues, particularly if there's not things very local for young women in particular. Then for women as they go through childcare facilities at sports and leisure centres, whether you've had any thoughts around those. And then the third thing that's been raised with us recently, but in the longer term when we've done other activity around sport, is about the use of the school estate. It's an important point that keeps coming back to us again and again. So I'd be interested to know what work you have done or intend to do around that.
So I think these are challenges to women's participation in sport. Absolutely. So the issue of safety, the issue of safe transport to and from sporting venues, particularly, you know, we have long, dark winters in Scotland, and it is... not everybody feels comfortable out and about at night, and not everybody, and you know, some environments, frankly, aren't safe for women. And again, it's something that every woman makes decisions on every day in terms of, you know, it's just a reality of our lives, isn't it? That we make decisions and compromises about, you know, how much risk we're willing to take. I think that, you know, designing communities where there is good active transport links to sporting hubs. I mean, you know, just a couple of weeks ago, I opened the West Lothian Link, cycle link, cycle track, and it was just phenomenal. And it was linked by active transport routes, well lit, beautifully made, that you could cycle basically to this cycle track from many parts of the community around it. I think thinking about these things is really important. Thinking about public transport, I mean, in my part of the country, public transport doesn't really, well, so where I live now, public transport barely exists at all. But where I used to live in the east of the Highlands, public transport tended to stop at a certain time of night. So these are undoubtedly challenges and barriers for, you know, women. And we do need to think about that. I think we think about it by designing public transport systems that are accessible to women, that are safe for women, and designing communities that are well lit and well, you know, well designed. I think I saw the evidence given by one of your earlier people who came and gave evidence to the committee, talking about, you know, how women feel more comfortable walking in a place that's overlooked. So where there are lots of windows looking out onto the path, people, women will feel safer walking there. So it's not always obvious what makes the difference, is it? But we need to do more research and make sure that our communities are safe for women. The childcare and caring in general, I think, is a really important one. I mean, one of the things I've been encouraging many sports to do is to think about opportunities to link up where women, you know, because women do a lot of the children's activities and organise a lot of the children's lives. So giving opportunities for women to participate in sport while their children are participating in sport. And, you know, I remember very well the first captain of the Orkney ladies rugby team who talked about her journey into rugby through being a rugby mum who had a hangabout for her wee boy who was training, and just thought, well, how about we start training ourselves? And, you know, within 2 or 3 years, that club, that women's team were picking up silverware. They were pretty phenomenal at it. So I think that's, you know, I think giving opportunities for women to train while their children are training. Jog Scotland do a lot of that. So they'll have groups, and I certainly used to participate in a Jog Scotland group when my kids were really tiny. I could drop my children off at nursery and then go for a jog with an inspirational group of, I mean, it's mixed gender, but it was mainly women because it was during the day, and there were, I mean, some outstanding older women in that group who gave me, as a young mum who was feeling very out of conditional, out of condition, a lot of inspiration about the potential for lifelong participation. So I think there's some real opportunities for collaboration that we can help. I mean, I think in that first postnatal year, more opportunities for, you know, yoga and exercises which might be focused on pelvic health. That would be a win-win. So just encouraging more of that with babies along too would be a really important way to encourage women with exercising. I think the school estate, again, you know, we've got lots of policy in place that enables the use of the school estate. There is lots of use of the school estate. We could, you know, there is more that could happen and further we could go, but we've made a great deal of progress, I would say, in the last few years. I think we've had a challenging few years with the pandemic where safety and, you know, protection against infectious diseases has been at the forefront of people's minds, and trying to limit the number of people who access the school estate in a day has been challenging, and it's been slow to recover post-pandemic, but I think that we're making progress there.
Nothing too much to add, as the Minister said, that the general principles of the learning estate strategy from the Scottish Government is that these community facilities should be open for the community. And again, it's been a while since we've done any research into that. I think 2014 was the last time Sport Scotland did a formal study into that, but Sport Scotland do speak regularly to local authorities and raise the school estate as a continual issue. And again, I think in many cases it is down to scheduling, and more so than facilities not being open. And again, it's just about working through all those challenges.
Point that was well made before is that it's open, but actually it's not been accessed. And I don't know if you've got any insight into why that might be. Has there been feedback to government about why that might be?
Yeah, it's definitely a difficult one, because on the face of it, the estate does seem like it's open. You know, gates are unlocked, but again, it's just about working with local authorities and governing bodies in particular to make sure that scheduling is right. And you know, the school quite rightly uses the facilities during the day, but then as soon as the school day finishes, then it should be available for the community. So it's just about working through those issues.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to now move to Gillian Mackay on our next theme.
Thanks, Convener. How do we ensure that an intersectional approach is taken with regards to improving participation in sport and physical activity, including people with disabilities, the LGBTQ community, and other marginalised and underrepresented groups?
So I think you're absolutely right. While there's a general concern around each of these groups and women and girls who fall into the individual categories, undoubtedly the barriers are greater for those who are in more than one group. I mean, I think disabilities is one that particularly challenges me. I think that we could, you know, I would love to see more participation across the board and more opportunities for participation. I went to a disability sport festival in Dingwall and I was so impressed by the work that was going on to target inclusion. And this was actually, you know, probably over a year ago, so it was at a time when we were still feeling pretty cautious about the pandemic. And many of that particular group had spent a lot of the pandemic very isolated and very vulnerable. And it was really joyous to see them participating in sport and participating sometimes with siblings, so brothers and sisters who never get a chance to play the games together or do the sports together in the way that other siblings do. So there's some really important work going on. It is bearing some fruit, but we could do more. Last year, one of the Sports Scotland sports young people sports panel did a very powerful course in making challenging all of us to reflect on how we could make adaptations to encourage participation of people with disabilities. And actually, when I speak to athletes or people who are participating in sport who have disabilities, almost all of them talk about how challenging it was to get involved in school, mm-hmm. and how they will have been told to sit at the side in PE classes. And that is, you know, actually as her education session amply demonstrated, it is really easy to make adaptations, which means that everybody can be included. And I think that's what I would absolutely plea for, is for every opportunity to encourage inclusion and participation to be made. There are some great examples. So I went recently to a badminton club that was run by a coach called Rajani Tyagi, who she won a prize, a Sport Scotland Community Coach of the Year, something like that. I've probably got the title wrong. Apologies, Rajani. But she had done some fabulous work in encouraging participation in the BAME community. And what she, I mean, it's just basic, you know, as you would expect. What she did was word of mouth. She targeted people. She made sure that it was a safe environment for them to come along to. She held it at times that suited them. So it was at 8 o'clock at night, which I personally felt was quite late for me to be running around playing badminton. But it worked because many of them had caring responsibilities. So it was a time of night that people could get out free of their caring responsibilities and participate. So that, you know, it's basic, isn't it? Ask the community that you're targeting what would work for them, and then do that and reach out. And she was doing, you know, she had a really thriving badminton club. She had also done quite a lot of work in cricket in targeting BAME participation. So some really powerful work going on. I think in terms of LGBTQ plus community, I think actually, and I think you've heard this from some of your earlier commentators, in terms of homophobia in sport, women's sport has traditionally been quite a safe space. Mm-hmm. And it's been inclusive and it has been welcoming to everyone. And I think that's something that we really, really need to be proud of and hang on to going forward. I think there is, you know, clearly there's a debate to be had about trans participation in sport, and there are some challenging conversations on that issue being had, but we absolutely need to, you know, have to plea again that we focus on inclusion where possible, recognising just how important the benefits are that everyone gets from participating in sport. For some communities, and each of the communities we've talked about, you know, will face marginalisation and, you know, challenging health outcomes. And sport can be part of the answer. So we really need to make sure that we consider inclusion where possible. As I said, women's sport has had a relatively healthy attitude in previous times to earlier discussions, and I think we need to hang on to that.
Absolutely, and as someone very much like yourself who found rugby because it's easier to stop things than it is to run quickly, I'm quite interested in how we include people with hidden disabilities as well, who may not end up qualifying for the disability sport side of things and end up in more mainstream sporting activities, as someone who's misjudged how quickly an opponent was coming at them and missed several tackles due to my hidden disability. It's how we make those environments welcoming and change some of that culture. You mentioned P as well, the ridicule of how many times you miss catching a ball and things for children with hidden disabilities is something that we need to tackle as well. What work is government undertaking to improve the visibility of disabled people in sport, including people with hidden disabilities?
So I think many of the sports are doing a lot of work themselves on that. So rugby is an excellent example. There's a club I'm pretty certain the Parliament team, Sandish Gulhani, may be able to contribute here as a fellow participant in the Parliament rugby team. But we play a team, an inclusive team, each year. I think it's called the Clan. Yeah. So they have some of the people playing in that team have hidden disabilities. Some of them have less hidden disabilities, and the roles are adapted so that everybody can play together. It's absolutely fantastic. I mean, I think wheelchair rugby is hugely inclusive. It's a game that men and women can play together. Often there are mixed teams. There are, I mean, I have a Twitter pal who has very severe. So I don't know her in real life. I have met her in real life, but mainly we're friends on social media, and she is desperately trying to get me to go along to on a Wednesday night training wheelchair rugby. And it's been a revelation for her. She has very severe asthma and has been prohibited from participating in conventional sport, but wheelchair rugby has given her the opportunity to participate again. So there are absolutely ways of adapting sports so that everybody can be included. And, you know, there are some... I mean, I think one of the people who got a coaching prize in last year's award ceremony was a lady from the Northeast, I don't know if you remember her name, who did the swimming coaching, mm-hmm. inclusive swimming coaching. And she was just phenomenal, an absolute power, who reached out to people who to get them involved in her sport and made sure that they could achieve absolutely the best of their potential. There's some incredible work going on out there. And I mean, it is... There are loads and loads of challenges and barriers, but there's some really, really good work. I go back to default setting, inclusion. Mm-hmm. We have to try and make sure that everybody is able to experience the benefits of participating.
That's great. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. I'm going to move to Sandish Gulhani, who might want to comment on the rugby.
Well, I tell you what, the one thing I would never be brave enough to do is do wheelchair rugby. That's quite scary. I would like to ask questions around ethnicity in women's sport because, you know, we've spoken already, you've spoken already, Minister, about how participation drops off. But that's even more acute when it comes to ethnicity. And you gave a very good example there of badminton, of a way to engage with the community. But my first question really is about information and data, because every single time we've had someone in front of us, I've asked them, what data do they have around ethnicity? And very few have come back and said, we have good data around it. So do you think that is an issue?
So I think it's certainly been a challenge in the past. I think we've improved our data collection over the last few years, and I'll let Andy give you a fuller answer on how we've gone about that. But certainly from a government perspective in our household survey, we're looking for ethnicity data as well as physical activity data. And in terms of sports governing bodies, the data that they collect, we're doing a little bit better. It is... I think in the past the data hasn't been there, and we saw that, you know, in health as well as in physical activity. It wasn't really until the pandemic that we actually went out and collected data routinely that gave us the level of detail that we would like about ethnicity. And then we really could see, whilst, you know, anecdotally there was lots of concerns about particular ethnic groups participating or not participating in the vaccine programme, we didn't know until we got the data. So I think data is really important. There's a balance to be struck. I'll let Andy tell you a little bit more.
Yeah, so as the Minister said, we have quite good national data through our national surveys. Health survey and household survey provide us a good level of understanding around ethnicity and participation. Sport Scotland collect a lot of good information, particularly around their major programmes like Active Schools, which used to really just look at participation stats, but now looks a lot more deeply about participants, who they are, where they come from, what they're getting out of the experience of active schools. So again, the data is a lot better, probably incomplete in some places, but a lot better. And again, the balancing act is always around, you'll have heard in previous evidence sessions that sport relies on a lot of volunteers. And again, there's only so much you can ask them to do in a participant session. you know, as soon as you start creating false barriers almost when you're asking for too much data to be collected, both for the volunteer coach but also for the participant who may not be keen to share that information. So there's definitely a bit of a barrier there around data, especially when you're dealing with volunteers who are just looking to put on a sports session, not fill in, you know, 10 forms. So I understand that the data we collect through our national programmes, you know, through us and through Sport Scotland, is not bad. It's pretty good. But again, some of that community-led, volunteer-led activity, there are some gaps, and I think we appreciate that.
So certainly at that community level, it's difficult to gather data, and I appreciate that. Yeah. But when you're an organisation and you're putting on organised events, I feel that, you know, you need to think about data, need to think about what you've got. And the reason I ask this question is because if you don't have good data and you've got a huge drop-off with ethnicity, well, why? And if you don't know why, then how could you possibly fix it? So once you've got the data, so you spoke about the household survey, you spoke about other ways that you're gathering data, also our organisations have also said they're looking to improve it. So now, once we get this data, will you centralise it? And then there's no point having it if it's not going to undergo some form of research. So what research are we going to put into place to really try to drill down and find out why people with ethnicity are not participating further as we would hope that they would want to?
So I think that individual sports governing bodies are looking at that in varying degrees, and they are, it's absolutely in their, they want more participation, so it's absolutely in their interest to ask those questions and to pursue the answers to those questions. I don't think the answer will be the same for every sport, nor will it, you know, it's also difficult to generalise about different ethnicities. So, you know, we saw that Rajani, the badminton coach, initially, I think, or largely, was targeting Muslim women's participation. But actually, there was a whole variety of different ethnicities coming along. What she'd done was created a safe space for people of all different ethnicities to participate in sport. Now, is that about, you know, there are all sorts of barriers in terms of, you know, certain religions might have rules around modesty or clothing, but not all of them have. So I think that once you get the data, you need to go asking, sensitively questioning what the barriers are and trying to take them away for people. You know, as I said, participation is key. We're dead keen to improve participation, and all the sports governing bodies will be trying to do that.
So just back to, you know, when we get data from sports governing bodies, because a lot of those who appeared in front of us don't have the data, mm-hmm. and said they are looking for it. So once we've got that, will it be centralised, or will you be able to access it, at least not to have an entire database? Would you be able to access it and then start to do research in it?
We certainly would be able to interrogate it to an extent with the individual sports governing bodies. As I said, though, it is a bit, you know, it's a challenging area to coalesce all of that data, I would have said, and to draw conclusions, because there are so many individual aspects to the sport and to the ethnicity that, you know, it's really important that we don't make assumptions, but absolutely open to having conversations about how we improve BAME participation. There are all sorts of immense programmes around the country trying to do that, and I think it's really important that we have the data to support that and to support investment in that to try to tackle some of the exclusion that is apparent.
I would just add, as part of our national governance structures, we have a data and evidence group that has main partners from across Scotland on that. So again, it's something we can definitely take away and look at in more detail.
Thank you.
Paul Sweeney.
A theme that's come up in many previous sessions is income inequality and that preventing access to sports, particularly, as was mentioned earlier on, where there are particularly expensive taxes in terms of transport, facilities, costs and equipment. What active steps is the government taking to provide support in that regard, whether it's in the form of grants or loans for equipment, or potentially even looking at things like kit libraries? Is there any measures that the government's particularly looking to promote to try and address income inequality as a measure of access?
So I guess the government has as one of its core missions at the moment tackling poverty, particularly child poverty. There's a recognition, poverty impacts all of your life opportunities, and participation in sport and physical activity is just one of the areas which it will impact on. It's really important that we don't lose sight of that sort of whole system approach and thinking about, you know, instead of finding ways to fix the problem like getting access to people for young people to sports bras, we also think about the bigger picture and how on earth can we tackle poverty and how can we make a difference there. I think is a really important thing for us to do. There are really good programmes as well in terms of kit libraries. Again, the Young People Sports panel came up with some brilliant work there. So led by young people, these are young people who volunteer for leadership roles within sport and are supported with by Sport Scotland to develop ideas and projects. One of the projects they were working on was this sort of kit library that people could access and share good quality items of kit. We need that work to happen at scale all around the country, because there is absolutely no doubt that it's a barrier for participation. I think that, you know, recognising the challenge for participation in sport, I mean, one of the challenges is if you're working three jobs and struggling to keep your head above water, it is very hard to get involved in leisure and recreation activities. So it's not just about the costs, it's about how tough people's lives are as they battle day in, day out with an acute cost of living crisis, which is what we're experiencing right now, and how hard that makes life for them. So I mean, I really think the big challenge to government, and we're seeing huge efforts across the board on that. And I think yesterday we saw some statistics which showed that in Scotland the level of poverty being experienced by children was 24%, 29% in the rest of the UK. So we're seeing some huge efforts and some benefit, but it's not good enough. You know, we need to do more because living in poverty is all consuming. It's hard to think about anything else if you're struggling to get access to food and heat and shelter.
I think that's a fair point, and certainly one of the other challenging backgrounds. I mean, certainly I came from a low-income background, and one of the things I did as a kid was do swimming lessons, and that was because it was free. So my mum was able to take me along to local swimming baths, and we mentioned earlier on about the cost pressures being faced. I think free swimming is increasingly a scarce opportunity for young people, but it's certainly some of the sort of statistics that have been put forward by Scottish Swimming. Around 60% of swimmers are female. It's the top participation sport for people with disability. There's clearly, it's one of the obvious community-based facilities which is accessible at relatively low cost in terms of equipment and so on. Yet these cost pressures, I think some of the councils have reported something like 90% increase in electricity, 200% increase in gas costs. I do know in England they've introduced a swimming pool support fund. I think it's to the tune of 60 million, of which is 20% revenue, 40 million capital, 20 million revenue. Is there plans to introduce a similar relief measure in Scotland to try and maintain access to swimming pools, perhaps conditional on things like providing free access to young people in particular?
So, as I said, those conversations are going on between ourselves and local authority partners and how we can ensure that the estate is able to, you know, that we're able to invest in the estate in a strategic way to ensure that participation is maximised. I guess the challenge with the allocation, we will have consequentials from that. So I think we get about 6 million consequentials from the spend that came from that Westminster decision for England. It does go into the block grant, though, and it's in the general allocation of our budget. So it doesn't, just because it was spent on swimming and swimming pools in England, doesn't mean that it will necessarily be spent on swimming and swimming pools in Scotland. And, you know, we make all sorts of different decisions, not least, I mean, in this space, the decision to fund the Scottish Child Payment, which is a uniquely Scottish benefit, which is having you know, it's game-changing, as commentators tell us, and is clearly having an impact on the level of poverty experienced by children and young people in Scotland. So we'll be, you know, I'll be working hard with local authority colleagues to try to see what can be done, but it's certainly not automatic that because that decision in Westminster was made to invest in swimming pools, that we would make the same decision in Scotland. And the Scottish Child Payment is a classic example of a different decision that we make in Scotland that is making a difference in exactly the same area.
There's opportunities to do things differently, and that might not be specifically, you know, it's not automatically necessary to read it across, but would you say there is a reasonable and pretty decent business case here to make sure there is targeted, discrete support for, I'm just saying this instance, swimming pools, because it is an obvious opportunity, whether it's designed in the same way, you know, it's a kind of secondary consideration, but actually identifying that particular issue about the threat to these facilities and addressing it specifically.
So, absolutely. And as I said, there is lots of work going on already in terms of collaboration across the board with Sport Scotland and local government colleagues to try to look at these issues and try to ensure that the sporting estate has adequate investment to ensure that, that we can continue to support. I mean, swimming is a fantastic example of a very inclusive sport, brilliant life skill, pure educational, you know, in terms of like learning to swim, learning to do something that's so frightening and succeeding at it is a brilliant educational experience. I absolutely wouldn't argue against investment in swimming, and we have, you know, lots of work going on to ensure that children at school can experience swimming lessons, but it's, you know, difficult financial times at the moment, and we're just going to have to keep working together at ensuring the security for the future.
Thank you very much, Minister, and to yourself, Mr Sinclair, for your participation this morning. Very much appreciated. At our next meeting next week, we'll be holding Stage 2 proceedings for the Patient Safety Commissioner for Scotland Bill, and that concludes the public part of our meeting today.